Here's the volume. Sorry, that was probably really loud earlier. And here she is. Oh, yes. Oh, hello, everybody. My name is Adam Pacitti, and I would like to welcome you to see you next Tuesday. I hope you are all having a wonderful, wonderful day. I hope you're well. We've got a really special show planned for you tonight. The 100 greatest TV moments from hell. And I'm just going to get straight into it, right? There's some viewer advisory is advised. What's the thing? Viewer, I've written it down. Don't watch if you're easily offended, because there's some stuff on here which is absolutely bonkers. It's really mental. This is it's about 20 years old or so, but it's showing TV from the last like 30, 40, 50 years, and there's some stuff on here which certainly wouldn't be aired today. Some stuff that viewers may find offensive. We've done our best to obscure as much of the really nasty stuff as possible. I say nasty stuff, the minges, the piss flaps, the tits, the bums, the willies, all that's gone. But it's gonna be racist streaming coming, you love to see it. There are things on here which are racially insensitive, that are sexist, and obviously we're watching this with a kind of, I guess, analytical way. We're looking back at what used to go on television and stuff that should have never happened to begin with. So do keep that in mind as we watch today's show. Thank you so much, by the way. I can see bloody donations and stuff already coming in. I'll get to them all in a second. So yeah, we've got 2.5 hours of this tonight. I'm going to try and keep it to about 3 hours this stream, because I've got to get an episode of Wrestlers of the Week online as soon as I'm done. So hopefully we're all going to enjoy this together for what it is, and for what it is absolute insanity. Truly. I've had a skim through. I know some of the stuff that's on there. We haven't cut any entries or anything like that, but as I say, we have had to obscure some bottoms and some willies. And some fannies and some boobies. So let me have a look at the donations. Thank you guys so much. We're already on a level 3 hype train. Bless you. Thank you so much. Some bumpers, exactly. Get your bumpers out for the lads. Stephen Scott. Oh, thank you, Stephen. 1,000 bits. Thank you, mate. Hello, Adam. How are you? I'm good. I woke up literally about 3 hours ago. I didn't get to sleep until about 8 a.m. last night. But I managed to get like 6 or 7 hours sleep. Yeah, I'm feeling all right, actually. I'm feeling all right. I'm worried about not being able to sleep properly tonight. And then tomorrow, you've got me, you got double Pacitti tomorrow as we watch some more British TV, because they told me I've got to do that first, and then play Raid Shadow Legends together. So please do join and download the game tomorrow using our link so we can get some money. Lovely to see you today. Hope you're able to get some sleep after the stream. Very excited for this fun and amazing stream. Really been enjoying the streams over the past week. They've been so much fun. Get the cat excited. You love it. Getting all the catchphrases in there, Stephen. Big love to you. Big love to you, Stephen. Thank you so much. Thank you. Very, very generous of you, mate. Cheers. Clapped, thank you very much for the resub. 8 months there, much appreciated. James Clare, yay, 5 months only. 5 months, thank you so much for the resub also. Wes Bray gifting out a sub as well to Kirk here. Thank you so much, Wes. Nice to see you. To see you, nice. Stephen Scodes, a gifted sub as well to Ken. Thank you very much. GY Goliath with 5 gifted subs. Bless you. Thank you so much. To DMC, to Miss Amy Louise, to Blast Processor Over, to Tom Phillips, and to Mia. Thank you very much. Thank you for your generosity, guys. You guys are absolutely wonderful. Thank you so much. And thank you to everybody who joined in with the Raw stream last night, where we paid tribute to Brody Lee. And the second stream tomorrow will, of course, be the AEW Dynamite reactions, with 100% of the proceeds going to charity. So please do join us there tomorrow. But thank you to everyone who did that. And also jumped over to Twitch because I didn't want to go to bed and be on my own. And where we played some Brody Lee matches, some Luke Harper matches. Ricky Morton was the shining star last night, which wasn't expected. But there you go. There you go. So, I did lose quite a lot. Morton Mania was very much running wild last night. Those 2K streams never go to plan. Dark Blue. Hey, Adam, how's Mr. Happy doing? Also, can we see Jackie? Ooh, I don't know if you can see Jackie. No, I think I've got him queued up. Happy's good. I had a cuddle with him this morning. No, you can't see Jackie. Yes, you can. Just a second. It's in downloads here somewhere. What's it called? Like Woolworths ad. It's going to come in really loud. Guard your ears. I'll turn it down. Oh my God.
Hi guys.
There he is.
It's Jackie Chan.
A little half-assed Jackie, so, that one.
Ready for the party?
Sure. As I say, we got a new computer for doing all this streaming stuff. So I've had to set everything up again, and I've got some weird shit to sort out tomorrow with the Raid Shadow Legends thing. They told me I've got to have like a weird stream set up for it. So yeah, I'm taking suggestions, I guess. I was thinking, but it's too long. I think it's too long. I was thinking of doing Big Fat Quiz of the Year, one of the old episodes, a Big Fat Quiz of the Year, and then we'll get into Raid Shadow Legends. Does that sound good to everyone? I think that could be a bit of fun. Anyone in the chat? No, Noel's house party went down like a fucking sack of shit when we did that last time. Yeah, all good. Cool. We'll do Big Fat Quiz of the Year. I think there's some on YouTube. Let me just check that before I lock it in. I'm sure there is Big Fat Quiz of the Year. How long do they go for? 1 hour 30. Oh, spot on. There you go. Big Fat Quiz of the Year 2006. Yeah, we'll get away with one of those. Cool. We'll do Big Fat Quiz of the Year tomorrow, then we'll do an hour and a half of that, and then I'll play some of that shitty mobile game. Nikki wants to play. Thank you very much for the resub. Much appreciated. GeForce, where have these months gone? I don't know. We've been saying it a lot, but fucking hell, 2020 has just, in some ways flown by, in other ways, dragged more than any year in memory. But yeah, thanks for sticking with us. We're loving doing the Twitch stuff. We're having a whale of a time with it. We're launching some new Twitch shows next year as well. Possibly some wrestling stuff. I don't know. We haven't quite figured it out yet. But there's more Twitch stuff coming. So thank you very much for joining us. We're approaching 20,000 followers here on Twitch, which is absolutely nuts. Because we started with zero, obviously. Then we did Twitch for a little bit and we got like 6,000 followers. And then we've built on that. We've had another 13,000 people follow us this year. And we're just having so much fun doing it. So thank you so much for joining us. Much appreciated. The content you and your incredible teams have put smiles on mine and many other faces with YouTube and Twitch content this year. Have a good new year, guys. Thank you so much. Have a good new year to you too. Happy new year. 6 months there. Thank you very much. Bools22 gifted out a sub to PainlessJam52. Thank you. Stephen Scodes, I think you mean viewer discretion advice. That's what I was looking for. I've written it at the bottom of the thing. I've got a bloody warning. Also, Jorge27 asked if you put a mature audience tag for the stream. Yes, I have, yeah. So I don't know how that works as far as people finding it. Hopefully the notification's gone out and everything. As I say, there's not a huge amount of swearing or anything like that, and the nudity's been obscured. This is very much a look back at what some very popular British TV used to be. There will be stuff on here that you'll be familiar with. There'll be stuff on here which will probably be very new to you, unless you saw the show 20 years ago. Or lived through it, God forbid. It's gonna be a fun one, I think. Consumable Pete, thank you very much for the 100 bits. Here for the fannies and the willies. Sorry, I apologise. I'll send you an uncensored version. I found this on YouTube anyway and had to have it edited. So they got away with it on YouTube. There aren't any like full on. I don't know what I'm doing there with my hands. There aren't like any exposed labia. But there are some. There's a dingle dangle. That's for sure. Shout out to Andrew if you're watching. Hello, mate. My dabber is out at work and my body is ready. Be careful. Be careful. Thanks again, Pacitti, for the nonsense. Thank you for joining me for the nonsense. Adam, evening, Adam. Looking forward to see you next Tuesday tonight. Can I have a dose of Jackie, please? Let's do it proper. Let's do it proper. There he is. And here he comes, and once again, there he is. That's more like it. Nailed it that time. There you go. Thank you very much, Akadjua. Adam, nice to see you. To see you nice. Michael's 95. Hey, Adam. Hope you're well. Nice to see you as always, and thanks for the stream yesterday. Let's get our dabbers out and have fun. Big love to you, pal. Big love to you, too. Thank you so much for the bits. Sidos, thank you. Brand new subscriber there. Thank you for joining us here. Much appreciated. Stephen Scode's gifting another sub. Bless you, Stephen. Thank you very much. Congratulations to Jeff the Mongoose. Moo Cow Biscuit, a brand new Prime sub there. Thank you very much. Much appreciated. Sky 92 gifting a sub as well to Dysfunctional. Thank you ever so much. Alex Takeover. Hello, big boy. I'm excited for the stream since I woke up this morning. I've been looking forward to this one. I've been really looking forward. I look forward to all of them. I was buzzing about the Christmas one, but this one has... I feel bad because somebody recommended this show and I can't remember who it was. So if it was you, thank you very, very much. Somebody tweeted it to me, I believe, so I could probably find it. Anyway, whoever recommended this, thank you so much because I think it's going to be a really fun stream today. It's going to be a bit different. I don't think we've done one long, long watch-along of just one show. And I know it's a clip show, basically, but generally we squeeze three or four different shows into it. So this is a big countdown. Hey, we're doing a bloody list. We're doing a list. We're doing a top 100 here. Alex, thank you very much. Lord Brotovic, thank you ever so much. 8 months there, thank you. Hello, handsome Pacitti. Just wanted to take this sub as an opportunity to say thank you for all the work you and the lads have done this year. Truly helped me get through each week for months. Also get that raid money, my dude. Yeah, so I'll just explain this. So please do tune in tomorrow. You don't even have to watch me play the game if you don't want. There'll be a link there, and if you download it, and play the tutorial, and play it. I think you've got to play it for like 5 minutes, then that counts as us getting one download. We get 125 download, they're giving us like a grand. They're giving us like a grand. We're getting a couple of hundred quid just for doing the stream anyway, but they're giving us like, so I just thought, oh fuck it, we don't normally do stuff like that. But hey, January is always the worst month as far as YouTube goes. The ad rates just go, like they half. We lose money every year in January. So I thought, fuck it, we'll do the Raid Shadow Legends thing. We'll have a laugh with it anyway. Homestar fan, thank you very much for the bits. What's your opinion on WWE doing a new gaming series despite preventing their talent from streaming games on Twitch? I think it's very hypocritical. I think it's very, very poor timing, very poor PR on their part. I'm not surprised they're doing it. They'll do whatever they want, won't they? Thingamajiggly, thank you very much. Hope you had a happy Christmas. Merry Christmas. Hope you had a wonderful time as well. Happy New Year. Rizzo, brand new subscriber there. Thank you very much, Rizzo, for the Prime sub. Reese, hi Adam. I've been a big fan of the channel since day one-ish. Have you ever watched Taskmaster? I think you'd love it. I have seen it. I've watched the episodes with Daisy May Cooper on it, because I'm a really big Daisy May Cooper fan, as well as Charlie Cooper as well. Obviously, he doesn't appear on the show, but This Country, I think, is the best thing that the BBC have done as far as comedy goes in like the last 10 years. So I loved seeing her on it. I don't know who's won yet, so I'm actually probably going to watch that tonight, thinking about it. So yeah, I think it's a great show. There are a couple of episodes on YouTube. All of them are on all four. Thank you very much. Much appreciated. Yeah, it's a really great show. It's a really great show. Missing Flatbread, thank you ever so much. For the entirety of 2021, who would you pick as your three world champs to have a year-long reign? Raw, SmackDown, AEW. See, I don't... Well, I wouldn't be adverse to having Kenny hold the title for the entire year. On the WWE side of things, Big E is a year-long IC champion I would be up for. I'm assuming you're not just talking about world titles here. Raw, SmackDown, and AEW. So yeah, okay, SmackDown, Big E then, because people want to see Big E get into the world title picture as soon as possible. And I think that's fine. I wouldn't be unhappy if he won the world title at Mania or anything like that, or won the Royal Rumble and went on to headline WrestleMania. That's cool, but I'd also... Like, a really long mid-card reign for Big E would improve that belt's prestige, so I'd be well up for that. And on the Raw side of things, I'll go with Asuka, you know? I don't think she's going to at all, but her holding the Raw Women's title for a year and getting into basically re-establishing another big, long, undefeated streak, I think would be quite nice. I'll go with that. Exile, thank you very much for the bits. Love to see Big Willie Pacitti on a Tuesday night. You'll love to see it. Thank you very much. Nice to see you as always. Charlotte will have that belt before you know it. I know, Kate. I know. Ian, Ian, thank you so much. 10 gifted subs there. Much appreciated. Congratulations to Nadia, Megan, Claire, to Dr. Alarming, to Sal of the Dead, to Junior Davis, to Cherry, to Tojin, to Willy Hawks, and to Mr. Who's Numbers. And there's one in Japanese there that I'm not even going to try to figure out what it says. So thank you very much, Ian. Cheers for the gifted subs. And Matt as well, gifting out 5 subs. And Rossman gifting out 5 subs. Bloody hell, thank you guys. Thank you so much. Chili Jason, E. Barley, Lobster Thermidor, Chippy Lowe, Connor Fatboy, Marshall, Mose by Dick, MacIver the Mark, That Damn Potato, and Gord's Pal. Thank you to all of you for the gifted subs. Thank you so much. Thank you. And Rossman as well, resubbing there. 9 months. I don't think anyone's got the full 12 yet. I don't think I remember reading. Maybe I've missed it. Maybe I'm misremembering or something as well. But I don't think anyone... We're getting there. We're getting to 12. Look at that. It literally just popped up there. Fred the Shed subscribed at tier 1. They've subscribed for 12 months. Are you the first, Fred? You might be the first. Look at that. The fucking timing on that. Were you waiting for me to say that, mate? 12 months, 1 year. Round of applause for Fred. Thank you so very much. Thank you, mate. Sean, great to see you, Adam. Lovely to see you too. 3 months. Thank you very much for the resub. Vice Wolfpack, thank you very much for the resub. 2 months. Thanks for all the amazing content. Much love and I hope you're staying safe during these times. Thank you very much. You too, mate. Happy New Year as well. Missing Flatbread. Oh, I've just read that. Hope you have a wonderful 2021. Hope you have a wonderful 2021 as well. Thank you so much. Cheers for the donation. I don't know why it went through twice. I think it did anyway. Matt Thux, thank you very much for the resub. 2 months there. Thank you, sir. Booker Jertaz. Looking forward to finally relaxing after having such a horrible week. Watching you always helps. Well, thank you. And hopefully this will take your mind off what has been a dreadful, dreadful week to be a wrestling fan after a horrible year of it anyway. It's just so nice to see the community come together, and not just the cultaholic community, the pro wrestling community as a whole, and the stories that have been shared and the love that we've seen, the outpouring of love has been really, really heartwarming after just such horrible news. Moo Cow Biscuit, thank you very much for the donation. Hi Adam, been a big fan of yours for a long time now, even spoke to you over email in 2013. That is a while. What was I doing in 2013? That's before the billboard. Girl of my dreams. So I figured it was time for me to sub and donate. Well, thank you very much. Much appreciated. Welcome. Glad to have you here. Long time fan there. Nice. Kate Quinnell, sounds like tomorrow will be bollocks. Count me in. Get the raid excited. Exactly. We'll all spend... I've got to do it for 2 hours, I think it was. I've got to do gameplay for 2 hours. Stephen K, love the streams, Adam. Thank you very much. 4 months there. Much appreciated. Oliver B. Webb, thank you for the bits. Evening Treacle, caught up with the Christmas stream on Boxing Day. Christ, Nijpak is the man. Yes, he is. But most importantly, I'm genuinely gutted that the Warjo story is over without success. You say that, but he beat Way of the Warrior, and only 4 people, including Warjo himself, have ever done that. So he's the winner in our hearts. I don't think he lost. I think he fucking smashed it that day. So well done to him for appearing on that kid show like 15 years ago or whatever it was. I was buzzing when he passed Way of the Warrior. I know you have a bet to do it, but don't worry, you'll be getting some gifted subs from me as well. Call it a late Christmas present. Thank you so much. Cheers. Hope you're well. Enjoy your evening. Enjoy your evening as well. Thank you very much for being here. Not actually Tesco. There he is. More exciting than for tonight. See you next Tuesday. More than excited, sorry. Thank you for keeping me up and running all this time. Much love. Hashtag STD. I almost said it again. I called it STD yesterday. Hashtag STD. Jorge, Adam, you deserve some praise. You're a great streamer, bring joy to thousands, and your haircut looks great. I like you. I like you a lot. Also, play your cards right with Brucey for Tuesdays. It's on Cleop's channel. Yes, I've got it bookmarked already, actually. We'll do that soon. We'll do that soon for sure. Thank you very much for the kind words there, especially about my hair after you were all slagging it off yesterday. I haven't forgotten. Forgive, but never forget, you little fuckers. Declan, Adam, anytime there's a lull in the stream or you need the toilet, reckon you could play my MIDI cover of John Cena's theme song I uploaded to YouTube. Yeah, why not? Why not? I'm going to try and do this without pissing. I've just had one. I should be grand. We'll see. Sidos, hey Adam, I'm a big fan of the channel and a bigger fan of you. Thank you very much. You're one of my biggest inspirations and I can't thank you enough. Keep up the great work. Thank you so much. That's really very nice of you. You need to find a better inspiration, to be honest. You need to find a... somebody who is worth your time. But thank you ever so much for the kind words regardless. James Carey, thank you very much for the resub, 4 months there. Story Now Horsebox. I don't know what that means. Story Now Horsebox. Anyone? Fred, once again, thank you very much. 12 months. Random Noun, thank you very much for the Prime sub. Brand new subscriber there, thank you. Deck New. Hi, Adam. Had a tonsillitis flare-up overnight, so on antibiotics. Not a wrestling fan, but absolutely love these streams. I missed the Christmas stream. How did Warjo do? He didn't do it. That little fucking ginger prick did. But Warjo won our hearts. He had already done that. But that's the important thing, isn't it? Thank you very much for tuning in. Joel, Adam, what would you cook on Come Dine With Me, and what would your entertainment be? Ah, that's a really tough one. I do a good sweet chili squid. That's a people pleaser, isn't it? Not the vegetarians and vegans. But I think that would go down well. Dessert. Creme brulee. Quite like a creme brulee. Starter. Ugh. Just a shite soup or something. Do a really average, like, just a can of Heinz tomato soup. And then everyone's thinking, oh, this is going to be rub. But then they'll be so impressed by the other courses that they'll be like, Jesus Christ, he's pulled out of the bag. Entertainment. I'll just have a sing. I'll just do a bit of karaoke. Everyone likes that. G Daniel, thank you very much for the resub. Hey, Adam, looking forward to tonight. Will be a good way to relax after coming out of hospital. Thank you for the streams. I hope you're well, mate. I hope everything's all right. I'm glad to hear you're out of hospital as well. Hope you're good. Happy New Year as well. I hope 2021 is better for you. Ash Jamling. I don't know how to pronounce that. It's an L, isn't it? I don't know. Ash. Hi, Adam. Thank you so much for the streaming. I hope these recent streams aren't burning you out to the extent the ones earlier in the year did. No, I'm feeling all right at the moment. I think it might catch up on me in January a bit. Plan is end of January, beginning of February to take a week off. Or maybe hold off and go down to the Isle of Wight for Christmas in March or April or whatever. I'll figure out. But I'm feeling good. Ryan Moore. All right, Tory cunt. Has anyone recommended Stars on the Rise 1993 Xmas special? I heard the first act was class. Moving swiftly on. Rye Levy, thank you very much for the bits. Stephen, been so much fun watching and modding these streams. I remember emailing you after you guys started working from home, and I said to you, if you need anything, I will help out as much as I can. Without thinking, it was me being there for every stream during Pacitti Mania 1. The streams have been so much fun this year. You're a huge inspiration to me, and I appreciate everything you've done for me this year. Well, once again, Stephen, I can't say it enough times, but thank you very, very much for everything that you've done for us. Thank you for always being here. You are a godsend. You are a wonderful man. Thank you very, very much. Cheers, mate. Send your sarcasm. Did you contact the now not so ginger prick Jado on Instagram from the link I sent you on Discord? Mate, I looked at it. I can't believe how much he's changed. He's a completely different man. I still hate him. Don't get me wrong. But we'd love to see him on the stream with our boy Warjo. No, I'm not giving him the airtime. Fuck that. This is Warjo mania. Forget Pacitti mania 3. This is Warjo mania. What are you talking about? Declan Malloy, do you have to pretend to be loving Raid for the 2 hours, or can you be honest and say it's shit? Well, the brief is like, be honest, but keep in mind it is a sponsored stream. So I'm gonna praise it loads probably. I'll just be like, oh, this is really good. This is I'm having the most fun that I've ever had. But in the back of my mind, I'll be thinking about like watching the bottom Christmas special or Antiques Roadshow and stuff like that. From what I can gather, it's one of those generic wait for hours or spend money games, so have fun. Yeah, I will do. I'll have a whale of a time, I'm sure. Apparently the graphics are really good. I've got the PC version, so if you want to play along, you can download it on Android, iOS, or PC using the link that I will provide tomorrow. Please don't download it yet. So yeah, I'll get that up tomorrow. And we'll watch Big Fat Quiz of the Year, and then we'll get straight into Raid Shadow Legends. Jurassic Pork, thank you very much for the resub. 7 months there. Beautiful stuff. Guys, I've got through all the donations. Thank you once again for your overwhelming generosity. You guys have been amazing. Not just today, not just this week, not just this month, but for the entire year. Well, for the entirety of Cultaholic, and even before that, What Culture, you guys are the best. So thank you very much for continuing to watch our stuff. I'll give it one last plug. If you want to subscribe, you can do so for free using the link that's right in the chat there. You can do so for free by linking your Amazon Prime account up with Twitch. It takes 30 seconds, gives us a few quid. Or you can pay a fiver a month to do it. Or you can tell me to fuck off. I don't really mind either way, because I love doing these and I do these for free. So thank you very much. Homestar fan, have you ever watched Would I Lie to You? It's a great show, but I'm not sure it would work for one of these streams. They pop up on my YouTube recommended all the time, and I always watch the clips. It's the one with like... David Mitchell's on there, and what's his name? What's the guy's name? He's got glasses. He's a slightly older chap. I say that he's like 50 or so. What's his name? Lee Mack? Is that Lee Mack? Rob Brydon presents it, right? Is that Lee Mack? Yeah, I guess it is Lee Mack. Yeah, it must be. Yeah, I've seen a few bits, and I always enjoy. I've seen Andrew's name there. He's in the Andrew. Say hello, mate. Andrew, little Andrew Dingle. I see you watching, mate. Come on, you can. Come on. Average Gamer. Hey, Adam, sorry I missed the Christmas Day stream. 15-hour shift from hell meant I couldn't drop by. But Merry Christmas to you all. 15 hours on Christmas Day is fucking miserable, mate. I'm really sorry to hear that. I hope you had a good day regardless. I assume you just worked and then slept. But I hope you got to enjoy a nice dinner or some chocolates or some beer or something. Thank you for everything you've done for this year for the Cultaholic family. Let's all have a great 2021 and get those dabbers out. Come on. Is he there? Here he is. Hello. Hello. It's a Laura fan. Right, we're going to get on with it. So this, once again, is the 100 Greatest TV Moments from Hell. It aired, I think it was on Channel 4. Yeah, it would have been. It was on Channel 4. And once again, just in case you missed the opening disclaimer, I'm having to do a Nige pack here with an E. This is a naughty look back at some very just like shit, like fucking why was that ever on TV? And then also some why was that ever on TV? There's some pretty insane stuff here. So once again, viewer discretion is advised. I nailed it, Stephen. Viewer discretion is advised because this is pretty nuts. This is pretty nuts. But fortunately, you won't see any actual nuts because they've all been edited out. So let's do this, shall we? Let me get my headphones on. How is the audio as well? I've got to check that. 4x3 over there. So I won't be able to give you too much insight into these clips because I wasn't alive for a great deal of them. But it is pretty mental how this stuff used to air. See, that viewer discretion advised contains footage some viewers may find offensive. I can't hear anything. What's going on? I think you guys can hear that. Desktop audio is coming through there. I'm plugged in. That's the problem. There you go. How's this for you? Does that sound all right? Sounds nice in my ears. All good? Sound's gone now. Oh, fucking hell. this is going well, isn't it? Desktop audio. How the fucking hell do I do that? Did I just... So it was on and now you got nothing? Yeah, you got nothing now. What the fuck? Maybe if I add another audio input on this. Add audio input. Device. Nah, that's not going to do it. What the fuck? Andrew, help! Help! I could stick it on a USB stick, I guess, and bring it over that way. But then I won't be able to like skip through it or anything very easily. Boomer Adam can't figure out computers. Fuck, it's a really complicated setup. It's a really complicated setup here. That is desktop audio. What are you fucking on about, OBS? Settings. Audio. Desktop audio. I've got it.
Classic dramas.
How's that for you?
Defining documentaries and oh so hilarious sitcoms. But it's not all Fawlty Towers, moon landings, and Kathy come home.
All good? Oh, wonderful stuff. Sound all right? TV history. And Gary Sport, with stick to his eye, who remembers the past? Old Finnish idiom. With stick to his eye, who remembers the past? I don't understand it, Gary. Thank you very much for the resub, though, mate. Bloody Zoe Ball. Is she still on the telly? She do radio now? Oh, a little bit of cartoon tit. That's all right. We'll get away with that. So yeah, this is like TV moments gone wrong, as you can see, right there. TV moments gone wrong, some general naughtiness, but also some pretty horrible racism and sexism. Twiggy Mike, shit, I'm late. Have I missed anything? We're just getting started, mate. Which programs have we got tonight? Just the one. Any Christmas stars in their eyes with your favourite singer?
Let's be honest,
I think Zoe Ball married Fatboy Slim. Yeah, yeah, she did. Yeah, I think she did.
Is it because eyes black?
Bit louder.
Tonight we serve up the biggest collection ever.
Test 1-2, how's that for you?
A bit
better?
The under-rehearsed and the un-PC.
So get your dabbers out for this absolute insanity. It's a 100-point countdown. This is going to go on for 2.5 hours.
Had these tales the unexpected never unfolded. So sit back, zip up your protective clothing, and
zip
feel
up.
The heat of the
100
moments from hell, as voted for by you, the viewers. Let's hope your favourite's in there. Hell hath no fury like a viewer scorned.
And at number 100.
To begin with, evidence that even TV legends presenting current affairs shows can find themselves in situations that are both live and dangerous.
Still want it a bit louder, or is it all right?
Hello, good evening, and welcome. Later on, we're going to...
One of my very earliest TV memories is of David Frost.
Turn up
a
bit.
This guy was hungry, he was desperate for it, he was in the zone, and he would do edgy programming.
Better.
Jerry, you asked if you could be joined up here by two of your colleagues. Would you just... like to introduce them for us?
And he invited along, I think the guy's name is Jerry Rubin, an American who led the Yippies, an American politicised of the hippies.
Let me know if it should stay the same.
You don't need notes.
But they're minor.
Tear it up.
You're cheating on this quiz.
You don't need notes.
Right, for $20, the following question.
I
do need. Do you smoke dope?
No.
Well, let's try it.
Because
try anything. Try it, David. Try it, David.
No.
See, you're trying to get intellectual explanations for what the new society is going to be like, but you won't even try this.
You need to. If you don't smoke weed, you won't understand the world. That's how it works. I hate it.
The F word, and I think you may have even heard the C word, and I'm sitting
there. Try it, David.
It's fantastic.
Try it.
Robert, come on, Robert, come on.
That's Jonathan Ross's brother, right? Paul Ross.
Come on together.
Robert's fine.
Robert, come on.
I feel like this was the inspiration for one of the early episodes of Knowing, well, they only did one season, didn't they, on TV? Knowing Me, Knowing You with Alan Partridge, where everything goes wrong.
I'm leaving my area, and I'm going to go and stand here with the audience.
I think I feel more like being over here.
Okay, so show!
What are they covering him in?
Oh, pathetic.
Oh, pathetic. A gay, shut up, you were dead years ago. You were
look
dying.
At that.
You were dead years ago.
Die.
So pathetic and so childish and so pointless, and we'll be right back.
And I thought, that's a TV presenter. He took the count in the face of this madness, and nobody in the country is going to switch over.
They're dreadful, aren't they?
Where's David going to take us next?
Wait, this isn't called cunt anymore? Am I still allowed to say cunt? Yes, you are. Can you clarify the use of the word cunt, please?
Now,
I'm going to still say cunt.
It's
just we changed it so that when we're plugging
and
it on Twitter and that, people don't have to basically see that word. There's no change to the content.
The
it's not a big deal.
Oh,
shit.
And our acts are staggeringly awful.
My name's
please
Fred
no.
Tom, and I'm this morning.
Please no.
My woody jumpers.
Imagine old new heaven.
My name is Denise
Spot
Roberts,
on.
And I'm this morning's
oh,
agony.
Oh, Denise,
aunt.
The agony on.
I appear regularly on the show with my colleagues Brenda Romanis, Nina Mishkoff, Charles Metcalf, and Susan Brooks. Just
walk in. Oh. We haven't watched any of these ones, have we? Fuck me. I want to say, it's just a bit of fun, but it's also quite offensive in itself, isn't it? Have you tried weed, Adam? Thank you, Gary. I have in the past. It doesn't do anything for me. It makes me feel poorly.
It was part of that first wave of daytime TV, of programming in the mid-70s, when prior to that, there'd only ever been ill people, small children and housewives at home. And there was this geezer, Ulf Göran, who I believe had taught all of Scandinavia to play the guitar in like 8 minutes.
Now then, I am trying to do my very best to talk in a language which is not my own. And sometimes I do many mistakes, as you can hear.
Poor old Ulf obviously couldn't speak English very well.
Anyway, I do my very best and I have many happy times thanks to that.
You know,
he's cute.
Sweet.
What was it now again? When I...
He doesn't know what he's doing. Bless him.
Did you teach her to play those songs that went, no, John, no, John, no, John? Music you've never heard anywhere.
He's another guy that I only ever see pop up on these sorts of shows, or did 20 years ago.
repertoire.
Crank the volume up a little bit more. Yeah. Yeah, I don't. This is one that I'm not going to speak over as much as I normally would.
Now, confessions better? Of dodgy sitcom writers and film star Robin Asquith.
We know the network asked for more adult content, Adam, but we would have settled for a woman asking to be set on fire. But if anyone asks, this stream is for educational purposes to see how times have changed, that we're not all racist, sexist cunts, except the host hosting this educational. Me, piss off. Sorry, let me skip that back.
Star Robin Asquith milking the larves in a series that was soon forgotten.
I don't remember this.
That's right, Mr. Johnson's been on the phone.
Oh, not again. She's always on the phone. What's she complaining about now?
Her tits.
Her blue tits.
Pardon?
They've been at the top of the milk again.
Oh, those tits, yeah!
Gentlemen, classic comedy. Roll? Yep.
In your own time,
Tony Banks.
Roll away.
TV Hell is full of people who should have known better, doing things they'll later regret. Here's the ever-reclusive MP, Tony Banks, getting involved with something dopey. Prepare cannabis
in much the same way. Oh, why would you agree to do this?
Oh. See what we've got?
Trying to get, like,
have a convincing winner. Is that?
Yes, be in there with the kids.
Of course it's smokeable. I pronounce Tony Banks the winner of the Who's.
He's a fucking MP. What other drugs have you tried, Adam? Nothing really. When I get released from prison, I'm going to come over and try some poppers. No, Gary. Although looking at you, you may be a little old for me. Regards, Paul. Thank you, Paul. Yes.
Hi, my name's Baz, and me and my mate thought.
Is this a fast show sketch?
Wasn't now.
Youth TV was still in nappies in the early 80s when the BBC started making programmes for teenage eyes only. One of the first to hang around on a street corner looking for trouble was the Oxford Roadshow, a bizarre mix of music and right-on political agitation.
They said it was ready, steady, go for a new generation. And they had that The Weekend Starts Here, which is with the great Ready, Steady, Go slogan. And it was Friday afternoons at 6:30 or something, as I remember. It was live. And they said it was going to have all the kind of excitement and energy and anger of youth.
Who are you?
Williams. Why don't you tell them the truth?
We heard this morning that several more have been accepted on youth opportunities programmes.
Okay, it's just a big con to cover up the real unemployment figures. It's 6 months slave labour and then you're back on the dole.
That was one of the terms that they said to me. It's going to be dangerous television.
Ignore the number in the Radio Times, we got it wrong.
It was dangerous for me. A, I nearly got run over by all these cameras and I didn't know what was going on where. And secondly, it was very dangerous for my career because nobody knew what they were doing.
I don't know who he is now. Anyone?
Hey, you've got to do this.
Is he Curly Watts?
No. As for you lot, you can let us know what you think all about this simply by giving us a bell.
It's a programme for young adults, young adults, and concentrating on all the subjects that young adults are interested in, like unemployment.
The 2UC sponsor, Jobs Express, is going to leave Newcastle on Monday morning with 25 unemployed youngsters on board.
He couldn't sound more bored. He's worse than Fash.
It was before everything came with a
three shows for the future. I'm not sure I've been watched yet. Ice Warriors, National Lottery, Big Ticket, and Winning Lines. This might have also been a lottery, but I remember a contestant winning a trip to Spaghetti Junction. Rob, thank you very much for the resub there, mate.
How are you gonna be able to make yourself felt to a lady who is, you know, much? Surely, is an intelligent lady. She's been, you know, college. She's done the whole bit. Dave.
Dave?
I just tell her how it feels.
And I remember having a battle with a BBC producer and they proposed some preposterous idea. And I remember turning around and saying, that's not going to work. That's not going to make good television. And he turned around to me and said, I'm not here to make good television. I'm here to start a revolution. And that is, this bloke honestly thought he was Fidel Castro on BBC Two on a Friday evening.
Oh.
Did you see that? Did you? The voice of youth. They're still wearing flared trousers.
One of the greatest of all time. I love Rick Mail so much. Adam, I was having a rough day today with my mental health, so I watched the Christmas stream back on video on demand. Nice track, cheer me right up again. Bless him. Thank you very much. It's amazing, like, how much you guys enjoyed it. I'm really.
If you want to
well,
be,
he's very flattered, and I'm chuffed.
You are.
What?
Albion. Free State.
At 94, the sort of weird moment that TV throws up from time to time. This was part of a series giving anyone with anything to say the chance to broadcast it live on BBC Two. Sadly, once the man in the monkey suit had gone, it left the director with nothing to do but zoom in and out very slowly on this tree for 10 minutes.
What?
And now that embarrassing first appearance they all want to forget. Thank God for videotape. It's Roland Keating and the rest of Boyzone on
is
the
this, It only
show.
Takes a minute, girl. No, no, it's a different. Fuck me.
Come on, you two.
Dungarees.
You're never going to keep your place in the band like that.
Incredible. They used to wheel this clip out every time, like Ronan or Stephen was on a show. Right, this is where the racism starts.
Immigration by blacking up as an Asian factory worker. Goodness gracious.
I'm from the unemployment exchange. They are telling me there might be a job here.
Ah, there is. Yeah. Then again, there might not be. You from India?
Pakistan.
With curry and chips, it was so blatantly, let's have a laugh at the wog.
Bloody mixed and coggers and rednecks and pickaninnies and coons and wogs.
Jesus
I tell you
Christ.
What, if they sent all the wogs back home, we'd have an extra hour of daylight.
It was really shocking to see it.
Got your lunch then?
Yeah, yeah. The jokes were always like, you know, about just being coloured or being an Indian and all that. And I think
what
that,
year
that
was
they,
this? I missed this at
really
the start.
It really helped race relations anyway.
He's a foreign gentleman.
Do what?
Pakistani.
Now listen, we've got our coloured quota. We don't want any more blacks.
You can't count him. He's British. He was born in London.
I think we can look back at programmes like that now and we can go, God, how did that ever get through? But isn't it good it wouldn't get through now?
Well, I'll tell you one thing about the wogs. You know how to treat the women. They keep them right down, they do. They keep them right under the cosh. When a bloke
evil
dies
stuff
out there in Wogland, they burn his missus.
1969.
That's not funny.
I think it was right for that day, and I think curry and chips was right for that day, and I think now we can do the same thing much more subtly.
Tonight I'll take you down to my local. There you'll meet the true British love tonight.
Not our local.
Yeah, the Black Swan.
Some say Pebble Mill should be in
moving
top
swiftly
100,
on. There's some of that, as I say, viewer discretion very much advised tonight.
Down the years.
Oh, I've seen this 50,000 times.
Shane launching an unprovoked assault on the Righteous Brothers.
You never close your eyes anymore when I kiss.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah. And there's no tenderness like before. In your fingertips, you're trying hard not to show it,
baby.
But baby,
not even the backing singers can sing.
Baby, I know it. You've lost that loving feeling.
Fantastic television. That's more like it. This is the one that they parodied
Welcome
on Not the 9 O'Clock
Origami,
News.
The art of folding paper.
They obviously realised that paper folding.
It's crazy to see some of the stuff they got away with years ago. That's disgraceful, isn't it?
So to try and make it a bit sexy, they gave it this gloss.
What, 50 years ago?
Like sort of James Bond. But it looked like James Bond would have been if it was set amongst a photocopier salesman in Guildford.
And a very big welcome to the inner sanctum. You know, you can't paper fold, you can't do origami without paper.
Hey Adam, wishing everyone a cult holic triple jump and its viewers and subscribers a happy new year. Sadly, so much of 2020 can go fuck itself. There it is, there it is. Here's hoping 2021 will be much better for us all. Thank you so much for the bits, Mark. Lovely to see you. And Gemza, thank you for the resub.
And I'm just folding, you see. Like
this is so good. So good.
Please go and fetch it.
This ran for 4 years.
Like protective clothes that look like kind of an overall.
Imagine paying your TV license for this.
You might get a slight paper cut at the worst, but you don't need.
It is Mr. Bean.
Your glasses.
I'll just fold you something which I think you'll like very much.
Mel Smith as well. Agreed, Gar. An absolute legend. One of my favourite Christmas songs as well.
There it is. That joy of all paper folders. Japanese flapping bird.
Here's a little bracelet, and here we have a nice pair of earrings, and of course a moustache.
Moustache.
Oh.
These days, the pop video's taken the place of many a live performance. But back in the 70s, the Old Grey Whistle Test featured them every week. Here's John Otway and Wild Willie Barrett demonstrating why a video's much better for keeping that cool rock star image.
Alone in my bed. Sounds like bloody Trey Parker doing it. Oh, fucking hell. Cheryl is going home.
In the late 70s, the BBC said, hey,
Redmond, thank you very much for the resub as well, mate.
Kids,
cheers.
By the kids. Well, because they were rubbish at it, that's why.
When I come to London, I feel a bit distressed because it seems rather impersonal and unfriendly. I've written a song which seems relevant to that.
Oh, no.
Harold Wilson once said that a week was a long time in politics. But could his TV career last even that long when he became the first former Prime Minister to host a chat show just 3 years after leaving
Downing
Street?
Oh, careful now.
He was the first television Prime Minister. He mastered television. He could read autocue like nobody else.
Good evening.
I just reckon that if he'd chaired cabinet meetings for 11 years, it wouldn't be very difficult to chair four guests and a chat show. But right from the first show, when Harry Secombe was the first guest, it became apparent that he wandered off from his brief and he sort of preferred an informal chat.
Can I just start by saying, I remember once I was in the Isle of Man, the only time I've ever been there, I was addressing the National Association of Colliery, Overseers, Deputies and Firemen. And I went to the hotel restaurant, there you were, having a meal after a double bill in a single night in the theatre.
I could see the Harry Secombe interview was falling apart towards the end because they'd run out of questions.
Oh!
And what do you say you're doing tonight?
And obviously the show was going at the wrong pace. And I was doing everything in my power to speed it up. And I'd be lying if I were to say I wasn't panicking. I was, and I was reviewing my options about how much we could edit, how much we could shorten.
Was that the whole story, that culinary story?
Let me introduce the lady described by Jim Callaghan as the sexiest thing on television. Pat Phoenix.
Oh, he's so nervous, isn't he?
With Harold doing his links.
Really makes you think, while the British people got to pay for a license to watch shit like this. Yeah, mate.
And him doing his wind-up. And after he'd done it,
it's nuts.
The crew broke to have their dinner. I said, well, we'll do the show at 7 o'clock. And he said to me, haven't we just done it?
Oh, man, he thought it was a rehearsal.
In my youth, I did play Shakespeare, Desdemona and things like that, but I'm a bit past it now, I think.
Now, tell me...
Say no.
Oh!
Go on, tell me, what do I got to tell you?
We knew that it hadn't come off, and everybody was a bit shaky, and we knew we had to come back the next week and do another show, because I wasn't prepared to cancel it, we'd announced it. And when I met Harold on Monday morning,
when he went, so what are you doing tonight?
In 11 years
what
as Prime Minister,
tea,
I never missed a night's sleep, but I haven't slept since I did that show.
Well, I was going to ask. I mean,
I didn't.
The audience said no.
Fabio, glad to be back, Adam. Love you. Love you too. Thank you very much. Nice to see you. Cheers for the resub, mate.
But he must have known that within himself, his mind, even in his late 50s, just wasn't the mind that he wanted.
He's late 50s there.
I'll be returning.
He's not fucking late 50s.
Of the back benches at Westminster. But thank you for looking in. Good night.
He can't be. There's no way he's late 50s there. 150s, maybe, yeah. Hard paper round. Oh, he's suffering from Alzheimer's.
Now it's time for some music, and the song is called Relay, and the group, the fabled The Who.
In his chat show career, Russell Harty was to deal with all sorts of awkward customers. He was quite struck by Grace Jones, remember? In the early 70s, he got a hint of the hell to come when The Who nearly wrecked the studio and his wardrobe.
Tell me, sorry, Russell.
It's a great sleeve, that.
It is, yeah.
If you touch my bleeding sleeve,
no, hey, he's getting stroppy now. There's you leaving sleeves alone. Yeah. Personal them, hey. Can't touch the interviewer, can we? Hey, no, he's in command, isn't he? Can make everybody else look a right twit as long as you don't have a go at him. How long have you been happily married, then? Hey?
Now tell me, when your husband gets out of bed on a morning, what menial task do you do for him first? At 85, a reminder of some antique domestic heaven and TV hell.
Does your wife have your slippers ready for you? And tell me, when Glyn gets home, do you have his slippers ready for him? Yes, you do. He gets them himself, or doesn't he wear slippers?
He doesn't wear slippers.
He doesn't wear slippers is the right answer.
Well done.
If you wonder Sky doesn't spend billions on exclusive rights to arm wrestling, why. It's Fred Truman's Indoor League.
The idea was to...
I feel like that was parodied by the Harry Enfield, you know, the Women Know Your Limits sketch, which was really clever.
Or even a domino player or an arm wrestler.
Well, this must be just about the most powerful right hand wrestler in the world.
I feel like I would watch
absolutely
this.
Absolutely invincible. He's like a big coloured steamroller. Deedee's battling on. Trying hard, but he's going. Richardson
commentary.
Has got the power. Has he got the glory to go with it?
It was that, to them putting on the Henley Regatta, and all sports that I didn't think should be on telly. Anyways, we've got our sports on now.
If Maid Marian and Annie Oakley were alive today, there's no doubt where they'd be. Here.
Bang. 40. Bang. 60.
60.
Bang, bang, bang. You can't get much steadier, and any man would be proud to have her as a partner or a wife.
It's just lowbrow redneck entertainment.
Sorry. That fucking commentary. Maybe I wouldn't watch it. I take it back.
What became world coverage of darts, because darts had never been on the telly till the Indoor League.
125.
Proper Yorkshire TV. Andrew, you used
Harry
to watch this when you were a nipper?
Darts player, 5 times world champion at the age of 16, looked at the Indoor League and said, I'm going there.
So it's fun. Yes, more not the 9 o'clock news.
And it's a good start. Double vodka. Single paint. Another double vodka.
100 milligrams.
100 milligrams.
The other sports fell by the wayside. But I'd love to be remembered.
I was born to this program.
But she'd hit me on the television.
And he gets one in the top.
One start.
We'll take a break now. Then a couple of shakes, the final of the American pool.
He's class. The fucking pipe in his hand and everything. Oh, we're back.
Welcome back. And let us now pause and remember the words.
They're only going to get worse from here, by the way, guys.
Their careers so that we could be here in hell today.
We're just getting started.
Pioneers of groundbreaking experimental television.
I'm loving this show, by the way. Are you guys enjoying this?
In fact, so far,
it's worked for you.
The world still hasn't caught up. For instance, without our next programme, the word might never have happened. Imagine it. No sad, hopeful...
Four people said yes. It's all good.
No
Bruce
de Cadenet. No Terry Christian.
Again, if you're just tuning in...
Just imagine.
Parental advisory is advised. We're not celebrating this stuff. We're looking back on it.
Yes, at number 83. It was different. It was challenging. It was incomprehensible. It was Club X, the Channel 4 performance art show that united a nation in indifference.
If Cultaholic made TV, this is it.
I always trying to get on Club X. That was a real precursor to the word. It took place in a different nightclub every week, and every week the show had a different theme.
I love it.
This ritual called Two Locomotives in Love with the Station Master is a futurist performance to start a very special party. And the whole purpose of this is to celebrate the fact that Club X is 6 programmes old.
By the time the thing started, 9, 10
o'clock... Hi, Adam, I'm sorry I was off during these months, taking care of my mental health. Pajamas. Thanks for being an awesome guy and saying really nice things on those emails. My pleasure, mate. I hope you're doing all right as well, buddy. Hope you're good.
Paul Morley, why did you call your record company Zang Tum Tum?
It was very simple, just the 3 syllables, Zang Tum Tum, seemed to be very important for the 80s.
We all sat there absolutely blottoed.
OK, well, thanks very much,
Paul. Is that it?
Yep. All over.
What about fascism?
No, nowhere into fascism. Oh, hold on a second. No,
go on,
sure,
Paul.
The show seemed to be not really happening.
Go on, Paul. Talk about fascism.
No idea what was going on.
Bristol Cronin, if you can hear me.
I thought it was somebody with a Hoover. I thought they got the Henry out.
Art, the food critic for The Guardian.
So what?
The food critic for The Guardian.
And some guy started to come round as a part of this performance, pouring water over our head.
Christ!
Yeah, you need
I'd
to
be
do that
fucking livid!
When the guy came up to pour the water over me, I just turned around and I hit him.
Good lad!
It was just me.
Fuck that.
Running around, you know. People were in the toilets throwing up. People were on the floor. You know, 90 minutes of this.
So, to futurism, everybody.
Absolute mayhem. 1990. Popland Crackers. What the fuck? Nightmare Fuel coming up here. Oh, he's got little human hands. Yes, Adam and Joe.
25, 26 years. And I saw it again the other day, and it was like some repressed
abuse. I love Adam Buxton and Joe Cornish as well. But
from years ago.
Just I hate this.
The look of that blue Rastafarian lion was quite terrifying. I don't know what the logic behind that was.
I imagine all these actors in these awful animal
never,
outfits.
Never seen him before, who's this?
Who'd much rather be sort who's of playing this nobody? Shakespeare at the Globe. And they're getting at the director. The director's going, okay, this is like going to go, well, I don't think a lion would walk like that. I don't feel like a tiger today.
Is the drummer's the one off the Banana Splits, isn't it? Is it Gonzo
From
Bonzo?
From the world of international sport come the superstars.
England managers are used to coming to grief in front of the media.
Flawless Herbie.
But this sports contest had one who was doing it over 20 years before he became the boss, just by falling off a bike. Kevin Keegan.
Yeah, there's no way we're getting through this show without Jimmy Savile popping up somewhere. So apologies in advance.
Keegan on the inside. Van Vince, the other soccer player. And Keegan wobbling a little bit there at the start. Trying to put a lot of pressure on. He's wobbling on the track. Van Vince is just about a half a wheel up at the moment. And Keegan still wobbling. Coming to the first bend. And Van Vince comes across.
He's gone on the outside. He's throwing this. He's gone. Ooh, fuck that.
He's gone across the track on his back. Covered in dust. That is a terrible crash.
That's
going to
hurt when he gets in the shower. Fucking hell.
I just lay still for a minute, trying to feel what was broken or something.
Uncle Jimmy, I'm celebrating. Hopefully some of my glory years will come up, to be honest, from the grave. Stop it, stop it.
At number 80, Channel 4's attempted outrageous
I'm nicking this segment.
It's the girly show.
Kind of an Aussie pop poser whose cheesy grins
Sarah Cox? Sarah Cox?
Make him look like every neighbour's bin boy rolled into one. It's Peter Andre. You're so top with your soft pop version of swing beat. Well, the only swinging beat we can hear is your meat.
What a segment!
These days, with BBC and swine fever, we're used to country folk trying to poison us.
God, not the 9 o'clock newsers class. Mel Smith, Pam Stevenson, Lenny Henry. Adam, you should catch up on Channel 4's countdown of the top 20 shows of each decade. It's been on it. Yeah, I'm well up for that, mate. And Scary Lion, thank you very much for the sub.
Mournful music and that sound of that dray horse.
Wanker! You're a wanker!
Someone might feel suicidal.
Peter Andre every week.
Now, if you were a collector of agricultural antiques, of which there are many, you'd probably tell me that was a billet, particularly as I've just done
a bit of a
job with it.
And it would go, brass rubbing, thatch roofs, brass rubbing, thatch roofs, brass rubbing, brass rubbing, horse brasses, thatch roofs, voles.
It's a pick killer's cleaver. And I'd like to know if anybody else can lay hands on one of those.
I did love the Jack Hargreaves show.
And among the broom makers working with Hazel and Birch are a few, not so many, because they work with the ash.
My memory now, it consisted basically of him just sat in a hut with a piece of wood.
And they made the old wooden hay rakes.
This is
and
TV.
He was obviously the model for the fast show's Bob Fleming.
Fucking Bob Fleming, coffee.
On the show. Our old friend,
his mate.
James Thomas. Beg your pardon. No stranger to the show, has brought in some lovely old Victorian horse brasses for us to take a look at.
Look at his face.
Excuse me, Jed. Now, I believe there's something interesting about these particular brasses here.
I should Coco Bob. Now, the most interesting thing about these brasses is...
To be on
Next up, a confrontation is on the cards when the old meets the new and aging pop star B.A. Robertson comes a cropper.
Tonight is ladies' night. My first talkative guest is indeed a lady in every traditional sense of the word. All froth and flounce, acres of...
Excuse me?
Place, each and every sequence froth. Sewn on by herself, tireless night spent at home over the sewing box. Stocking seems absolutely straight and never ever a hair out of place. Talking to B.A., the bad prince of darkness, from Bow Wow Wow, the good Annabella Lewin.
What the fuck is he on about?
Annabella Lewin, the lead singer of Bow Wow Wow.
Because a lot of girls in the music business have a hard time, I reckon, because a lot of males find it easier to sort of take the mick out of them, which is really sad, because I think a lot of women have got a lot of talent. Mm-hmm. And it's not given the chance.
Carry on.
Right, I just thought I'd say that, make that statement.
That's all?
Yeah.
And would you think that people, guys in the music business, don't take them seriously?
No, they don't. They don't, not at all.
Do you think that's how I introduced...
You meet a lot of hippies, too. Like, you know, a lot of hippies who think they're really cool, like yourself again.
Yeah.
And, I don't know what the audience reckon, but I think it's a pretty shit show, basically. Yeah.
Would you want to go on?
Yeah, I wouldn't mind it. It's a lot.
Yes!
Oh my God,
I like it.
How do you know I love that colour?
I think I'm starting to love you more, Adam, for being an 80s, 90s British comedy fan and wrestling at this point. Great to find another fan of the genre. It's a blind date!
I need a steak knife.
Thank you,
Matty. A pair of scissors.
They've hidden the knives.
And maybe I can.
Come on, guys. No, you break your finger now. Come on, let's have a pen knife.
Guys, you weren't supposed to wrap it like this.
Oh, he's so Partridge.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry about this, Jim.
Right, it's fine.
When we said wrap the present, we didn't mean make it impossible to bloody open. Now, when you wrap a parcel for television, you don't wrap it like this. There you go.
Oh, gosh.
Please be taken up as well. Yes.
Oh, no. Person responsible, okay. Come on camera.
Yes.
Come on, camera. Apologise. He's so Partridge.
Oh, there's more now.
Fucking hell.
Okay. Right.
Aha. This is great.
It's waste paper basket, which is the waste paper basket that I loved.
All that for a fucking bin.
Oh, that is so pretty. That is beautiful. Thank you.
This is the brief that particular researcher prepared for us. So let's just christen the basket, shall we? There.
Love thy neighbour.
More racism now, guys.
Walk up and say how be ya.
When Love Thy Neighbour went out, it was a time of great racial tension. You were only a few years away from Enoch Powell's Rivers of Blood speech. And you have this sitcom in which the basic joke is, what would it be like if you had a black person living next door?
Hello? Anybody home? Hello?
Henry says now that... He
1972,
when he started off,
ran till 76 as well.
I'll move next door to you, and that was something amazing as it now is, that white middle class people, their dread was that that might happen, and this tries to make a sitcom.
It just exposed the ignorance of the white guy Eddie Booth in his attitude to his black neighbours.
A coloured family have come to live next door, and it's up to us to come to terms with it. We'll move.
All I wanted to do was to make people laugh. That's all I ever want to do as a comedy writer, to make people laugh. I don't consciously set out and say, this'll be good because it'll be racist and it'll be controversial.
What people remembered was the racist stuff, because as a child in the playground the next day, that's what would be repeated back to you ad nauseam.
I don't understand you, Eddie Booth. For years you've been shooting off your mouth about socialism and equality. Equal rights for all.
Equal rights does not entitle Nick Knox to move next door.
Well, they have. So you just have to get used to it.
Fucking hell. The rant of 76.
Is over.
Eight
and
seasons.
For the last time, thousands have marched at least some of the way along that road over the last 6 years, and 10 have come to the studio tonight.
Sometimes TV hell throws up some unlikely angels. So witness devil's advocate Richard Littlejohn coming to grief while looking for moral support on gay parenting.
Michael Winner.
From film director
never liked
Michael
him.
Winner.
We have the technology, we can do it, but does it mean
odd
that
man.
We should necessarily do things that we can?
Well, I'm quite appalled and very nearly walked out to be on a British television programme where lesbians are wheeled in for you to make smutty and offensive remarks to. I think it is an absolutely shameful exhibition of vulgarity directed toward a minority.
Fucking good lad.
I think the lesbians have come over with considerable dignity and you've come over as an arsehole.
Yeah, fucking hell! I take it back. I fucking like the guy. Jesus!
At number 73,
I wasn't expecting that.
The controversial
good
British
lad.
Comedian who became known as King Lear.
Benny Hill
the way
on
he
here.
Portrayed women in his TV show.
Jimmy, I'm going to stop reading them, mate. I don't want to do it. Come on.
Politically correct
what am I calling
about
Jimmy?
The way he treated women was, I thought,
ooh, audio's gone a bit funny.
You could hear underwater. The offbeats pound as they raced
Ernie.
Across the ground.
Benny was never sexist at all.
Hopefully the audio fixes itself.
And he galloped into Market Street, his badge upon his chest.
All it actually was showing was the hopelessness of men's sexual fantasies.
A lady known as Sue.
I've never really watched any. I know Ernie. What's the other song that he... Well, I know the...
Because there always have been...
Where he's literally chasing women, right?
...who will say, oh, in France he's regarded as a genius.
And he drove the fastest milk cart in the West.
But there's the more common reaction has been that he was playing a dirty old man
oh,
who
audio's
ran around
fixed itself.
After semi-clad women. And in the end, that's what did for him.
Went to 89.
When Benny...
I bet there was outrage
when
he got cancelled.
He was really shocked.
And it upset him so much, I think he went into a decline. It was part of the reason he died probably before his natural time.
What's been quite good for Benny Hill, certainly in terms of his posthumous reputation, is that in the 80s and
it is
well
the basis of Pat Mustard, yes,
now,
Sean.
This defence of irony came in, that he was somehow sending up the idea of the sex-crazed
ironic
man in the park. And it's very likely
I don't
that
think so.
Eventually we'll see seasons of his work on Channel 4 with serious academics saying that he is in the classic tradition of sexual farce.
And he drove the fastest milk cart in the West!
Do you want any Valentine's treats?
Politicians think the coolness
Mo
of some
Molum.
TV shows can rub off on their
they
public
They give her a deal,
image.
Though.
But this appearance by Mo Molum caused bad vibrations and had those Labour spin doctors gagging on their late-night polenta.
It's got five speeds.
Thank you.
But now, we've had Betty's tongue on the show before. There's
I've seen
Betsy
it.
Down there. There she
Hi,
is.
Betty.
Oh, I remember
I
Betty.
Have fun with it.
Yeah,
Do you
well.
Want to go?
No, thanks.
She's a good sport.
Five, four, three.
No
I used to love that show. It's so naughty.
For good cause, but the ITV telethon
Norton's great, isn't
stretched
he?
Our generosity.
On Eurovision as well, I think he does a really
hours
great
of live
job.
Entertainment from all around Britain.
That's me at the end.
Dave, how many throws have you actually done?
I think about 7,000.
The record is
20,000.
Fucking hell. Yeah.
That's me. It looks like Lake Farmer. If anyone knows who Lake Farmer is off Louis Theroux's...
And it's a 14-pound
Weird Weekends, was it?
So here we go, right. There you go. That's the first one.
Mr. Aspel, hang your head in shame. At number 70,
countdown.
One from the top carol and a couple from just below the belt.
Oh, is this
a
where she spells out cunt flaps? No, that was more recent
than
this.
Jars Brandreth's jumpers.
Now then, Gino.
Seven.
Seven again, and Lawrence.
Seven.
Seven. Let's say Lawrence is seven, please.
Not sure if I dare say this one. Wankers.
Wankers. Well, certainly it is said by many people. There's no question about it. Wankers. I'd be interested to see if that's got in the dictionary. Gino.
We've got Peter Wankers.
Peter Wankers.
At 69, no, not John and Olivia, but some criminal impersonators, and perhaps the worst performance ever.
Oh, not the old pair. They released it as a single.
If we got them on the record, the worse they were, the better it was. So I didn't have to worry about getting a great performance out of them.
You better shape up, cause I need a Oh, and my heart is set on you.
So 30,000 a day. We couldn't believe it. And then Eric Hall had the greatest idea of all. Let's do it on Top of the Pops.
My BBC at great expense and Top of the Pops.
I knew it was a bad mistake.
Have bought over especially for you right now.
I had the words written out on idiot boards.
The only real answer to
boards,
John,
I love that.
And John Travolta. Here they are in all their glory, Hilda Baker and Arthur Mullard.
I've got cheese, they're multiplying, and I'm losing control. Hold the power.
Oh, I need a beer. Fucking hell. Electrifying.
Watching it on television, seeing this thing, I would have been on the floor crying. I know that.
They don't even know the fucking words.
I was down the side of the stage, the kids were in front there, and they were all aghast, you know, these two people, you know. Because everybody knew the record, they just couldn't believe these two people were so bad.
Look at the one bloke trying to dance along in the front.
Oh, yes, indeed.
And it was a complete disaster.
And oh, my God.
The next day, we went from 30,000 records, in 2 days, we went to 250.
Fuck.
It just absolutely killed it, stoned it.
Guys. Well, there's your number 69. I'm just going to grab myself a beer. I'm not going to put on the John Cena midi or anything. Fucking hell, I need one after that. That is something else. I will be right. I just saw that. That guy is Adam in 40 years' time. Do you want to fuck off? You bastards. Right, I found one beer. We must have got through them all. Andrew been getting pissed on stream. I hope so. More like 20 years. Fuck off, both of you. Coffee Goblin and Fred there, you little bastards. Maybe 10. Right, let's crack on with it. You're the one that I want. You are the one I want. Oh, 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 buddy. Adam's the one on the right. Hey, oh, buddy. Flawless.
That's it for this part of the 100 Greatest TV Moments from Hell. The clip's more classified than
we'll
classic.
Skip the Zoe.
And all moments in television history.
Punishment idea, 10-hour loop of this song.
We, though, consider it our duty smell again. To mind you.
Oh, pink thing popping
oh
out.
Bloody hell.
Ho, 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 selector.
So what was this, 2001? I'm trying to think when Beau Selector
well,
did the Christmas special.
Jean-Paul Sartre is other people.
Adam, there's beer behind you. Oh, shit, there is, isn't there? Well done. People. Thank you.
Actually, Tomorrow People was quite good.
Harry, thank you very much for the sub, mate. Brand new subscriber there. Thank you.
One
once
man's
again, cheers.
Is another man's gotcha. There is no
Adam, look behind you. There's beer.
So here are some more TV moments that are
thank you.
Surely
Andrew, Andrew brought
to win
for
some
me,
award or other.
Yeah, I've got it, Declan. Thank you.
People are responsible. Who wants to pick it up?
Got myself a boondoggle. Love a boondoggle. Number 68.
The question I'd like to ask the people with me this evening is Rock and Roll Rebellion and Scaring the Pants Off Your Parents dead? Join me to talk about that. We have Tony Colston Hater, the man who's referred to in the media as the Acid House King.
This character that I only remember had a double barrel name.
Is that bloke
seemed
again?
Very edgy. Very overexcited.
We have Mr. Paul Morley, a journalist and broadcaster who was largely
what
responsible for introducing
about?
The world to Frankie Goes to Hollywood.
I've seen it. It's up there.
Don't deny it.
The thing I remember most is obviously the double barrel name man handcuffed Jonathan to his chair with some kind of stunt to publicise something he was involved in.
What?
So grow up, sit down and stop talking like the bollocks. Go on. What's that?
Oh, bondage.
Oh, no, this
the
is...
handcuff, this.
Well, basically, this is a protest on behalf of the Freedom to Party campaign.
The Freedom to Party.
It's almost impossible for people to dance legally past 3:30.
Well, let's be honest, who gives a toss, ladies?
Yes! Good lad, Jonathan.
And I just carried on almost like Jonathan did, as if this was just part of the thing. It was just one of those things. You know, it didn't seem to be particularly unusual. I think both of us fancied live television for being the kind of place where those things happen. The thing that got me the most was that at one point he threw a glass of water over me.
This bloke's job is just to get drenched on TV and then hit people. Go on, hit him as well.
Calm down or they'll all be at home putting their good life videos on, all right? You're not... Now, hold it. You do that again, I'm going to thump you, all right? And I'm not joking, so put it down and behave yourself.
And now, Adam, an example of how we just Bruno love it when things don't go to plan.
Probably Bruno, I think. Then
it's
Ali G.
It's easy
then.
To read what's on Roger DeCourcy's lips Borat, when Ali his act G, Bruno. Is sabotaged by kids during a live Christmas special.
I've seen this 50 times as well. This is great.
Ah, visitors. Yes. So nuts for the script. Yes. Good morning. This is Nookie.
He's moving his mouth. Citizen. And he's got the exact same voice as the bloke.
Of course he has, because that's the way it works. Mm. Hey, what did you get? If you pull that, it'll come off. Yes. Mm. You've got action, man. You do like pulling bears, don't you? He's ever so gentle, you know. He's not a frightened bear. I am at the moment. Yes.
I am at the moment.
Yes. Christmas time. Hello. Now, what does that do?
Blow it.
Oh, that's good.
And 66, one of the few sitcoms to get the chop.
Poor man. Yeah, he was a bit shite, though.
Ratings.
We're back
Isn't
to the
Johnny
racism.
Foreigner hilarious?
This is
Ask, mind your language.
Really insane. I've seen this before.
I used to have a French au pair, and every morning she came downstairs and said, Monsieur Powell, are there any French letters for me this
that's
morning?
That's the same voice. It's of the same I fucking writer.
I thought, well, this
it's
is
the same fucking guy. It's the same guy. Of course it is.
Trying to learn English.
Fuck's sake, mate.
Where are you going?
We go outside to have the punch down.
You mean the punch down?
I'm going to, how you say, knock his bloody block off. We see whose bloody blocker is knocked off.
So you had all French people, women are women, and they're beautiful and sexy.
I come to learn English. Have I come to the right place?
All Asians move their head like that when they speak.
I'm coming here for to be learning the English.
He's a bit of a fucking hypocrite Ross, right? Because he used to do this show called Endurance UK, which I think aired around this time. I want to say like 99 to 2000, where they had Caucasian people dress up as Japanese people. And he was doing this literally a few years before, basically the exact same. Does anyone remember Endurance UK? It would have only been a couple of years tops before this.
And everybody else sounds stupid.
And
Germans
he used to host it.
Unpleasant.
And your name?
Anna Schmidt, German au pair.
Usual German efficiency?
Germans are always efficient.
And they all came, nobody, to the same language school week after week, and nobody ever missed it out.
Taro, I am.
Ah, so.
They weren't caricatures, they were real, genuine, ethnic characters.
Fuck off, mate.
Very happy to be learning English.
We just took
the whole
the
joke is them they don't they speak
the
in
from each country and put them into the character.
You're full of shit, you cunt. What a load of bollocks.
Por favor.
Massively horrible emphasized stereotypes.
Raining.
It's just laughing at Johnny Foreigner, isn't it? Horrible fucker. As if he's defending it. All these years later and he's defending it.
Mind your language, even 25 years ago, is beyond belief. You just think, at what point did nobody go, do you know what, I just think it's probably a little bit offensive.
You're unemployed?
Yes, please. Only one day a week I'm working.
Michael Gray, the
what do you do then?
I'm going to the unemployment extension.
It lasted for 14 years. I don't know about that. I guess one season. Insane. I can't believe he came on and defended it.
Flying in your Spitfire over the English Channel. And I am in the Spitfire. And all of a sudden, I see in front of me two fuckers. I think to myself.
Look at Dez. He's not happy.
I must shoot one of the fuckers down.
It's got Stan banned.
Look behind me.
Banned from ten. Oh, wow.
At 64, some damning lines on the tweeness of TV poets like Pam Ayres.
My mum thought Pam Ayres was the funniest person in the entire world.
Cox. I love that shirt. I want that shirt.
It was down in the furniture warehouse as I wandered one morning in May to buy a settee for the woodworm. I'd eaten me old one away.
Pam Ayres, she had some quite smutty little rhymes.
She had
I am a bunny rabbit sitting in me hutch.
It was always like...
I like to sit at this end. I don't care for that end much.
Basically, the punchline seemed to always be maybe fuck.
I'm glad tomorrow's Sunday, cos with a bit of luck...
Frisson in the audience.
As far as I remember, that's the day they passed the buck.
She looked
It's naughty.
Who led rather a boring
naughty
life, but actually she was a simmering sex pot of 70s excitement.
Kai, mate, nice to see you. Thank you very much for the resub.
You find bargains everywhere, don't you? You see, how come you've such a terrific eye for it?
For some reason, Children of the Damned keep popping up in our TV hell.
Oh!
Here's James Harries teaching Wogan a thing or two. Like
she transitioned, didn't she? I saw her on bloody Naked Attraction or whatever it's called.
To have, they always should look old and they always should talk to
I hate comedians that their entire gig is cursing. Why are you watching me, mate? I'm not a comedian.
They should say...
Just shite.
Well...
What was her name?
They should have an image about them. And they should...
Sort of all.
Lauren, that's it. Thank you, Redmond.
By me, they should say.
Yeah, she was on Celebrity Big Brother. Of course she was.
Now, listen, may I just say, you are looking absolutely wonderful. Don't we agree, ladies and gentlemen? Looking great. Because I have to say, to start off, I have to say that you, of course, once were a fella.
Mm-hmm.
That is true, isn't it?
That's right. Well, you know, I was a man in a, you know, a woman in a man's body. And it took me a while to realise that, you know, maybe a long, long time. But, you know, we always keep things bottled up until we actually deal with them.
Now, imagine the most outrageous sitcom scenario possible. Let's say Adolf Hitler moving into the neighbourhood, slap bang, next to a Jewish couple. Tell me it didn't happen.
Well, Honey, I'm Home is basically the all-American
Nolly
sitcom.
Holder.
Whatever happened to the glamour? Where did the romance go?
How do I know where you put things? I can't even find my shirts.
It's two couples living next door in an apartment block.
Hiya, bub. Is he here yet?
Who?
And he always acting the clown, honey.
The one difference here is it's Adolf Hitler and Ava Brown.
Hi, honey.
I mean, my personal feeling is if you can laugh at the man, if you can turn him into a domestic fool, then why not?
Hi, honey, I'm home.
Cancelled during airing, says Elder Duck Quack.
What made it particularly reprehensible and indefensible was the fact that next-door neighbours were Jewish.
It's the Goldensteins.
And there was this this confrontation between them and the neighbours next door, the Goldensteins, which, in the light of it, was just pushing the taste factor just a bit too far.
You
just
wanted
a bit.
To get out that Adolf Hitler insults his neighbours? Now relax! Lighten up!
I think what made this obviously controversial was the fact that he was playing opposite a Jewish couple, which was somewhat different. And did raise lots of questions. I think that's one reason you do these things, that you want to bring things to the surface to talk about them.
You're right. I gotta think nice thoughts. Poland. The Sudetenland. France.
Okay. You got a better plan?
Yeah. We go in there and we punch their heads together.
Fucking
I think
hell.
Adolf Hitler, in comedy terms, is a gift as a central character. I mean, if
you
think
they were
of Basil
going,
Fawlty,
oh, the really controversial bit was the fact that he lived next to a Jewish couple. Yeah, that was it. Otherwise, no problem.
Now, if you got to catch
She's Lauren Harris now. She's in Celebrity Big Brother back in 2013. I know you didn't even have to look that up, Steve.
We continue to count down our shapely lineup.
Steven is
by
an encyclopedia
a
of
TV
knowledge
in the 70s.
When it comes to Big Brother.
It's those archaic regional beauty competitions at number 60.
Bit of blue for the dads.
When you're walking down the steps or along a catwalk and facing an audience like this, what's on your mind?
Nothing really.
Nothing at all?
No.
Shirley is a green-eyed, fair-haired hairdresser.
That is, I've just passed my City and Guild, and in 2 years' time, I hope to be fully qualified.
I remember this.
There's an incident with a child.
Oh, it's Big Break.
Where
not Big Break,
I was
fucking
doing
Big Breakfast.
An outside broadcast, and I was in someone's living room.
So join us for a streak as we mark the 2000.
Richard Bacon pushes over child.
Yes. Small child walks into the way of the shot. And I sort of asked him to, in a jokey way, said, can you leave? Yeah.
Look at
incident with a child.
There's
a lovely man who had two gone. Just don't hit the child, Richard, whatever you do.
What a heel turn.
I really thought that I was going to be in a lot of trouble.
His mum looks pissed.
Please, please, Richard, your handling of that small child was brilliant.
Oh!
A Pakistani and a Jew in a nightclub. What a fine example of an integrated community. Ladies and gentlemen, it's
Jimmy, thank you very much for the resub.
The Comedians was the now unacceptable face of stand-up comedy in an era before irony.
I remember Jim Bone being on this.
A generation of portly middle-aged
fucking
stars
Bernard.
And unwittingly helped
that
inspire
hair.
The birth of alternative comedy.
Still looking about 70 years old even back
at
then.
At the time, it was magnificent, and you had about 50 gigs per show.
The Irishman said, on our first space flight, we're going to go to the sun. He says, but pardon me, won't you get all burnt up? He said, no, sir, we're going up at night.
Get it, Irish
people.
I might
not like the subject matters,
stupid.
But all that matters to me is a joke funny?
The next day, he put him working with a... and the Sambo looked at him, he said... He said, where are you from?
I've still got an early 80s alternative comedy view of racist jokes and sexist jokes and everything. I even remember at the time arguing with my parents. I think there was a big generational divide. I remember my mum, God bless her, really isn't a racist, saying, oh, it's just a bit of fun. That's how she perceived it. For me, it was hurtful nonsense.
Do you know, I live next to a bloke and he's a nice fella. You know, he's coloured.
I talked about the Scots. I talked about the Irish. I talked about the Welsh. I talked about coloured people. And... myself in particular, I told tales against myself because they were funny.
No, it's the same with this race relations board, you know. It's a wonderful scheme that, you know.
I finished up getting one or two letters from Pakistan people, from Africans.
I'd have been on that if it hadn't been coloured, but it's a good scheme that.
I said, if you can't take the good, don't take the bad.
Two homosexuals. At the back of a van, having sex. They're over 21, what's wrong with that?
I don't give a fuck about losing, but I tell you what I give a fuck about, losing shite.
You never left Bacon, you're gonna have his arse! Get your fucking
back! That is the fucking straw that broke the camel's back. That is typical fucking Lake Norian.
Get it fucking done! Have the bollocks to get the ball, pass it!
Is that Peter Reeves? Is in the the one that they mentioned with is he Sunderland? I guess not the Scouse guy. Sunderland manager. Oh yeah, Sunderland shirt there.
And now the epilogues that used to send you early to bed before the advent of late...
Bit of a palate cleanser now after all the racism and sexism.
Down Farnborough. It runs down off the Ballyhope Moor.
Start stripping, gets Todger out, no doubt.
At times I was jumping like a mountain goat from boulder to boulder.
By about 3:30, it began to sleet. Now, I don't know about you, but I hate sleet. It's a sort of never-never land between a good downpour of rain and snow itself.
Well, I've looked at clouds from both sides now. And I'm reminded that it is simply...
I didn't say it was an entertaining palate cleanser, just a palate cleanser.
I think that colour, or the lack of it, is somehow superior.
Fucking sleep.
When pop star Glenn Medeiros had his latest record reviewed on Jukebox Jury, the panel knew one thing. They all hated it. What they didn't know was that Glenn was standing, waiting just around the corner.
Dick, what did you make of that?
Well, I don't know. Right lot of a couplers, that was, wasn't it?
Yeah.
No, but listen, it's quite raunchy and raucous. And say, for instance, you'd locked yourself in your fridge by accident. I'd put that on in order to alert people to my situation. They wouldn't come.
Nana?
What makes me laugh, right, is like three songs...
Oh, it's Fash!
...stepped off the surfboard. And now, after since doing a video with Bobby Brown, he's like, got all the dance steps, borrowed Bobby's shoes. He's like right in there with the groove.
Oh, his face!
Unfortunate for me because specially invited, he's probably coming to vote for Christmas this year. Glenn is here.
No.
And he is our mystery guest, and I can't apologise enough.
No. Fash is panicking. Vic and Bob fucking loving it.
Thank you so much for coming on, and as a special gift, I'd like to give you this original Pussan picture. Now, ready to take
Oh, he's so pissed. Look at Mortimer's face. He's beaming. Cheeky little boys. He's so happy.
At number 54, it's the long-running soap with wobbly sets and even wobblier acting that turned Crossroads into a household name, like Vim or Toilet Duck.
Crossroads Motel?
I was in terror, in fear and terror of doing it.
Ah, relief at last. There's no problems, not with the guests anyway, because everybody's out there.
There was an awful lot of pressure. Awful lot of pressure. You couldn't make a mistake.
Jimmy Gudgeon, you're demented. I'm a Scot born and bred in the, over the border.
We started at the beginning of part one, and then we finished Crossroads at the end of part one. And if you made a mistake, there wasn't time to do it again.
We think the grease was put there deliberately.
Oh, surely not. Mrs. Mortimer, in the last week, I've made a number of complaints about certain behaviours of Patton.
Wonderful things happen. I mean, Glenda Brownlow, her of the yellow handbag, right?
Something awful's happened.
Well, come on, girl.
Why is this teeny hell? Just because it...
And didn't come back for a year.
Mrs. Mortimer, before you go, I'd just like to say something.
And Hughie McPhee is still in the fridge trying to find a pork chop.
They've been placed there deliberately.
You can't expect the gods to smile on our little venture.
Because it was shit. Is it that simple?
What I want to know is, when do we get Wermink coats and our villas in the south of France?
And our villas in the south of France.
Anne George, who played Amy Turtle, she was wonderful.
Beers for Cheaty and a shit TV list is a late Christmas present. Bless you. Thank you very much. Cheers for the resub, mate.
And our villas in the south of France.
She would get very nervous and she would dry a lot. I mean, there's no question. She'd get very uptight. And at one point, she stopped. She was doing a scene with Ronnie Allen, who was being very
Mortimer, like Bob Mortimer, King. Yes, that is the Bob Mortimer, the train guy.
I'll come back in an hour and we'll have something to eat. Hmm?
And she said, I can't act with him. She said, he acts too fast.
Wasn't he concerned in a fire?
His house. He started a fire, accidentally. I spoke to him yesterday because of my suspicions. He had a breakdown, spent a while in a mental home. Yes, it'll haunt him for the rest of his life.
You forget that people laughed at it rather than with it. Right from the very beginning, people just say, oh, this is rubbish, and tune
rather
in
with
because
it,
of
like
the over-the-top storylines and the wobbly
much
scenery.
Of a comedy.
Everything you've ever seen on Acorn Antiques was
I know
true.
Acorn
Amy
Antiques.
Turtle was Mrs. Overall.
Oh, sorry, Mrs. Overall.
Here's your coffee, Miss Babs. What's wrong now?
Oh, nothing. Just a rather mysterious phone call from the Far East.
Well, sometimes that's God's way of telling you to think on and look sharp.
You're right. Gosh, I am awful. Here I am blabbing away about my own troubles, and I forgot to ask you about your husband's car crash.
Oh, he's dead, Miss Babs.
Thank you.
and when the producers axed her, a huge national outcry.
Michael Somerton, who was her agent, phoned her up and said that they are not going to renew your contract. And Nolly was absolutely desperate.
It was unforgivable. As soon as they sacked Noel Gordon, you know, Crossroads Motel, it was only a matter of time before it was burnt to the ground.
Oh, my God! Oh, literally. It's interesting, this. I'm really unfamiliar with it.
Most people knocked it, never saw
it. Who's your favourite talk show?
And
though?
They always felt it was the smart thing to do.
Oh, I'd put Graham there as well. I think Graham's really good.
To 17 million people who watched it.
Goodbye.
They can't all be.
Oh! Randy Orton strikes again. Oh!
Burn it down. And that's how you build your very own Crossroads Motel. And remember, if you do want to recreate the blaze that burnt it down, you'll need a packet of matches like these. And don't forget to ask permission of a responsible adult. Obviously not a Crossroads viewer. As to what's coming up next, now that's the burning question.
What does your real husband
mean? Oh, man.
Richard, you are my real husband. Remember, if you've got love life problems...
You're now going to be evicted, fellas. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. And it just ain't on, pal. It's a joke.
It just ain't on, pal.
It's something you certainly wouldn't have seen before on television.
Massive Tory sellout now.
The Blue Peter Garden.
Jeremy, fucking Blue Peter Garden getting trashed.
We're sorry. We're sorry. We're sorry.
Did they take a shit in the pool or
something? Because I was black.
Big preview there.
Welcome back to the 100 greatest moments of television, Sheldon Freud. Yep, we just love it when things go pear-shaped. You see, a lot of these moments...
Oh, it was oil, not poo. Right, apologies.
They just seem ghastly 30 years on.
Oil's worse. Great in the 70s, you fish a poo out.
Great in the year 2000.
We kick off this part with a show that took some really interesting things about growing up, like collecting crisp packets, and turned them into a much-mocked series for kids.
Why don't you just switch off your television and go home
to
do something
else for
it? It's remembered as being bad because it was presented by kids.
Oh, just schoolboy, don't you?
And which was the whole point of the programme. There's no way round that. And I think automatically, if
Adam, you seem like a responsible adult.
And you see,
can I start a fire, please?
Telly,
be my guest, pal. Kid.
Hey, see if you can work this puzzle out by just asking me questions. But I can only answer yes or no.
The whole premise of the program was that kids wrote in letters, and you'd, you know, act on the letters. You'd do the recipe that they'd sent in, or you'd play the game that they'd sent in.
Trudy Morris sent us in a long letter, and when I say a long letter, I mean a long letter.
You would get like 1,000 letters in the office, and 999 of them were chocolate Rice Krispies. That's all anyone ever sent in was
quite a long
chocolate
letter,
Rice Krispies. Double
space. Arrange some matches floating in a circle in a bowl of water. You can do that, Alan.
And the other one letter would be, did you know if you tied two Coke cans together with a piece of string, you could make a telephone?
She also says, dip in a piece of blotting paper and they should draw back. So I'll have a go at this too. Not really.
So all the letters were useless.
Heidi says she can't make it work either.
So I just used to go into W.H. Smith and go through all the children's books, all the hobby books. And I must have ripped off copyright like you would not believe. I stole every single game and every single puzzle and every single riddle on planet Earth just because you had to fill, you know, 25 minutes of a program.
Because the kids' letters were shit, is what he's saying.
Now, they're a band who started off look, very similar on. To yourself,
you
Johnny,
stop?
In the Sex Pistols.
Can you stop?
Yes, come on.
I don't give two what they're called. It's simple. Don't tell me I sold out, pal.
With
look,
the street?
I don't have to explain myself to anybody, and I ain't gonna really bother. Now, I was asked here, right, to interview with the band here, Pill, but now, like, we're facing a cheapskate comedy interrogation act, and it just ain't on, pal. It's a joke. It's a farce.
You mean you don't want to give any messages to
I don't have
the...
to explain myself. Sooner or later, somebody will open their eyes.
I mean, you invite the Sex Pistols on and this is exactly what you're going to get. Fuck me.
At number 51, it's the Entertainment Institution...
Ran for 20 years.
...that these days is resting in one. And let's hope they've thrown away the keys.
Now, figure this, right? It's the mid to late 60s, right?
You've got white men, mainly Welsh, because of their lovely voices.
Fuck off, you hypocrite. I can't listen to him saying this.
And big white eyes, singing songs that were written in the 1890s to the 1910s.
20 years.
That was what we were meant to be watching in the 60s, when the Beatles and the Doors and the Stones were happening. That's what was in our front rooms.
That writer's going to come on and say, well, I wasn't meaning to be racist.
From a minstrel tradition, and slavery was from a tradition.
It's absolutely insane.
I mean, some traditions, I'm afraid, you know, have to be got rid of if they're wrong.
One, two. A land of hope and glory.
You can't judge a show.
Oh, look, Adam Cole's raided. Hello, Adam. We're just watching some black and white minstrel show, mate. Thanks for the raid.
What was the motivation of people involved? Were they racist? No, they weren't. They was, you know, it was a very up show. It was a very positive show.
Oh, fuck you, Gary. Fuck you. Horrible stuff. Nelmes, thank you very much for the sub. Thank you. That's what made you subscribe, is it?
Guest stars queued up to cause controversy on the word, but all-girl rockers L7 won pants down with a shocking performance that gives a whole new meaning to the words.
20 million
rock bottom.
People watching. Right, that's the censorship, is it? I thought it was just gonna blur it. I need to see that.
On pants down with a shocking performance that gives a whole new meaning to the words rock bottom.
Oh. Sergeant Pacitti saving the day. Fucking amazing. There's a minge there, I guess. Sergeant Pacitti had to blur the naughtiness. God bless him.
Your buns to steel, but they also
I'm in shock watching this, and Gary's a big tit. I agree, mate. Yeah, so apologies to anyone offended. As I say, I did warn you guys. It's certainly not condoning this fucking horrible evening.
That's just how to do exercises in a very good bra. Nobody in that lineup's breasts move.
Great job, Andrew, mate. Fantastic job.
Those are some really good bras.
One, two, three. Rest a minute. Now, you rest a minute just while I'm talking to you. Now, the next thing to do is that we're going to sit up straight.
I can't believe anybody got fit. A lot of sitting and standing, sitting and standing. I think it's cocktail party keep fit.
You must be joking. Boom.
You must be joking.
The Becca woman really looked like when she was doing her keep fit class, like she was auditioning for the title sequence of The Tales of the Unexpected.
Made Andrew look at fannies for work. yeah, I guess so. Please don't go to HR. Mr. Turtles, thank you very much for the sub, mate.
This woman does are so bad for you. You know, kind of flinging yourself back like this. You know, trust me, that is not a way to keep fit.
Push back for three.
Her voice. Everybody push back ready. For three. Everybody ready. Jesus Christ, Andrew, where's Sergeant Pacitti for this?
And she was so bossy. She was fantastic. And she'd get these people.
I was saving my bits, but after Sergeant Pacitti, I'd like to politely ask if we could get that picture as an emote. Thank you, kind sir. We'll get on that. Yeah, we'll sort that out for you.
You're not bad, you know.
Fuck me.
That's got to be in.
Matt, thank you so much, by the way. Cheers, mate.
She was really the first in a long line of OTT. Fitness instructors, but the one that really used to get me, and again, she was always fully clothed.
Should we hear the music? Yes.
Was Mad Lizzie.
Now, guys, see what you can do.
Is that Robbie?
Get her inflicting her that. Exercise regime on Take That.
It takes a minica to fall in love. This is what I thought it was earlier. I must have seen this before. Oh, they're quite good, though. They're all in time.
Cross it.
Fall in love. Great song. Great dance. Here we go. Where's Nige back?
The 70s were a sad time for TV sports fans. In fact, just about the only live action on the box was wrestling on a Saturday afternoon.
Please no
with
saddle.
Men called Shirley, men named after outsized haystacks, and men in unsuitably figure-hugging
micro trunks. Fucking hell, big tip out there.
Called this sport.
Called this sport. Fuck off. Is that sometimes it? Oh, that's all we're getting.
By ordinary people on TV.
Some bits for Sergeant Pacitti that absolutely slaughtered me. Thank you, Michael, mate. Cheers.
To the mercy of the cruelest panel in showbiz.
I need to install Big Sergeant Pacitti as my malware protector. Thank you very much.
To be as honest as possible, to just be myself. And I have to say that I had a reputation. In fact, I had the nickname the Hatchet Man. I absolutely hated the song.
That's bullshit that they put wrestling in there. Oh, there was a man called Shirley and a bloke called Big Giant Haystacks.
Were failing. They're not together.
That's not a reason to put it on.
Singing or in their
millions were. The Queen was watching that.
Those 3 minutes, and they can be the most important.
No, Jarvis hasn't been on yet, Hugh. Would that have been afterwards? When did that happen?
I don't know what they were trying to do. It didn't.
He's always been terrifying.
No, not for me.
It does seem a bit amateurish.
We did nearly 200 shows, 1,000 acts appeared on the programme, and we were finding them in clubs, cabaret clubs and whatever, all over the country.
The Hart Family!
If I ever do any wrestling spot again, if I enter a rumble, this is my theme music.
Shot on new faces.
Tra-la-la, tra-la-la, twiddly-dee-dee.
While we were sitting, Carol and myself, talking about the
better be Cultaholic's go-to cinematographer from now on. Yeah, I think
place on the set,
that's a dead cert.
And a camera would be there to take in close-up his reaction or her reaction while the panel were talking about them. Now, that could be a killing shot.
Since we last saw her, she's lost a bit of her appeal, because I think it was great for a little girl to do this, but now she's, you know, she's looking a teenager with lots of teenagers doing what she's doing. Mm-hmm. I think her real appeal was when she was, you know, a few months younger and actually in a miniskirt.
She fuck me!
Working too hard now, and it seems
fuck
right.
Me! He's just said that on fucking... what a fucking creep. Fucking hell! I'm speechless at that. What the fuck?
Oh. One time, but it now just seems to be overdone all the time. I had to be smuggled out of the television studio on one occasion when I did give one artist to some very, very low marks, and his manager threatened to beat me up in the corridor. So they had to smuggle me out the back and into my own car.
Oh.
Come on, Tim.
Oh, six then. Oh, I know that you'll go
far, 'cause you're a star. This programme is about fashion.
Yeah. When Sergeant Pacitti has a heel turn, he will be a Jado sympathiser.
I'm going to go away and the microphones will not be on you and you can talk to your heart's content. I'm very grateful to you for coming along.
This guy used to get trolled quite often. I've seen a clip of Chris Morris getting in the audience for this and winding him up.
The reason why I'm wearing this is
don't enter the discussion.
Fucking hell.
Thank you. You've made your point. Thank you very much indeed. Okay, fellas, you're now going to be evicted, fellas. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Look.
I've seen this was live.
Chaps! Just hold that with you. Look, fellas. Security, we need to take them out, fellas.
We don't care about this. Anybody puts their hands on me, I'm going to have the look.
I'm not putting my hands on you, fellas.
Tiz Wars changed Tiz the face Wars, of children's go. TV. Suddenly, kids and their heroes could be naughty.
Oh, there he
and
is, Big Shirley.
But a late-night version for adults was to be far less successful.
Oh,
it was a series that confounded the critics and incensed the censors.
OTT, Chris Tarrant's adult follow-up to Tiz Wars, was an idea decades ahead of its time.
Okay. Cartoon boobs is fine.
All that laddish
Don't
culture
worry about
stuff.
That Curtis, thank you very much for the sub, mate. Much appreciated. All the lads made oh, God. Get ready, Sergeant Pacitti.
Call that entertainment. A duck-billed platypus just bums more entertaining than that, pal.
Now, we never sat down and said, right, you know, how can we make people upset? Or how can we push the boundaries? We'd set the mould, if you like.
That's exactly what the racist writer from earlier said, isn't it? We never tried to upset people. We just wanted to be really, really racist.
It's something you certainly wouldn't have seen before on television, I think. That's probably every chance you would see.
I spit the dog! Andrew, for the love of God, mate.
Very quickly, you've got a video recording. You can slow it down.
Please, Andrew.
It's just possible you'll see the minutest part of somebody's testicle.
But Andrew.
Some people must have done that. So, wait a minute. Just stop. Slow down. Frame it forward. Hold on. Get the magnifier. Yes, look.
Good job, mate. Well done.
And then right again saying that, you know, we were showing naked
men. Just a full screen. Right, there's too much going on there, apparently. Good lad, Andrew. Thank you. Yeah, I've been making Andrew look at Willy too. I didn't know. I said, have a check through this. I want to stream this. Bless you, mate. Thank you. I didn't know. He said after there were some Willys in that. It's got to be the coffin, hasn't it? Oh, it's just what Chris did next. They've forgotten Man Oh Man. What are they talking about?
Hello, welcome to day 9 of this series of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Now, all credit to Pan's people.
Andrew.
At one point, all the boys liked them and all the girls wanted to be like them. Then a strange thing happened. They started taking the lyrics too literally. Hence this memorably dreadful dance routine to Gilbert O'Sullivan's Get Down, featuring a pack of dogs. After this, the girls were soon hounded off Top of the Pops and replaced by Legs & Co.
So, I think Pan's people were the dance troupe when they couldn't get the band in, right?
Our TV nation usually turns to the BBC. But the live outside
Andrew
broadcast
deserves a bonus
has been
for
the
Sergeant
downfall of many a presenter.
Agreed.
So someone
cracking
must
work.
Have headed in for Jeremy Paxman when they asked him to host a discussion about the fall of the Eastern Bloc in the middle of a firework display.
Instead of closing itself down, and I think that's very important to be open to the rest of the world and not only German.
Now, I hope they could hear you in London more clearly than we could hear you here, because it is terribly, terribly noisy. But now let's... Charles Wheeler.
Jeremy, this is pure Monty Python.
I can't hear you.
This is pure Monty Python, having a serious political discussion in the middle of a firework display.
I'm only obeying orders, Charles.
He's not wrong, in fairness.
Next, the show whose idea was anything but sensible.
Shit.
What were they thinking of?
Mini
Pops. At 42, it's the painted babes of the Mini Pops.
This is...
Mini Pops is a very strange piece of television history because it seems
1983.
Incredible, it was produced by Channel 4. In their very early years. The parody of Channel 4 at the time was that all the programs were about social workers and very earnest political issues. And suddenly they put out this thing where you have very young children bopping around to pop music.
You can imagine to a bunch of right-on people, Mini Pops was a bit of a shock because, you know, we used to sort of sit and mutter and grumble about it. And this isn't what Channel 4 should be doing. Over the years, there's been a lot of traditional children's talent shows.
I'm not going to sing along.
The problem was they got it horribly wrong because other talent shows hadn't painted children up in quite that way and had them behaving like small adults.
First time I watched the Mini Pops, I think I was probably still at school myself, so there was a certain amount of envy involved. I thought, oh no, there's children sort of do, you know, on stage singing, and I want to do that. And then I think after about the second or third programme, it began to be a bit disturbing.
This is like a sketch from Jam, it is.
Time went on, people realised that perhaps it didn't feel as innocent as the producers thought it might be.
Well, the Observer called Mini Pops the worst of Channel 4. A comment surely close to libel. But Julian Bond did seem...
No, it's
upset.
Pretty spot on, mate.
It's certainly tasteless and appalling. The harder question is whether it's corrupt or corrupting.
Well, judge for yourself.
No, let's not get me fucking...
There was a groundswell from us within the channel saying, you don't really think that this is what we should be doing.
Certainly close to libelous. No, mate, no.
Other connotations.
Pretty fucking spot on, pal.
Just nice children performing. And when I took over entertainment, one of the first things I did really was remove Mini Pops because it, frankly, was a bit of an embarrassment.
I mean, if you put that show out now. I mean, the television station would be stormed. And it's this rather strange and bizarre piece of Channel 4's history that they could ever have been involved in it.
This segment's going on a bit, isn't it? Sometimes gone on.
Well, I'm sorry about that. Looks like we've had a power shortage or something, so we'll move on to the next item. And Martin Parr is one of Britain's leading photographers, known for his innovative colour work and for creating a new school of British documentary photography. We'll sort it out in a minute. His latest book, The Cost of Living, chronicles how the comfortable classes spend their time and money. But like some of
his
previous work,
he's come out as a COVID conspiracy nutter, hasn't he, as well?
Critics allege he's exploiting his subjects rather than making social commentary.
I have to warn you that there are five men in our monster filing cabinets. But one of them is your fiancé, Paul. All you have to do is guess which one. Okay, Private Dick number
one. No! Oh my God! Fucking hell! You could have made him a bit bigger, Andrew! Fucking hell!
Okay, Private Dick number three.
Oh, fucking hell, he's so small! Andrew, what the fuck?
It's Miss Marvel!
Oh, I'm fucking terrified here!
Oh. At 39, we give a well-deserved clip round the ear to the precocious
Sergeant Pacitti standing to attention.
Stars of 70s kid shows like Junior Showtime.
Oh, almost saw their maggots. Fucking hell. Oh, Matt, Adam, John.
Did you want to be on Junior Showtime?
Yes, desperately.
Why? It was full of. It looks as if it was conceived by someone who is fed up with everyone saying, "Oh, children are sweet and nice." Just make them do George Formby impressions and play the banjo, and I'll show everyone they're evil. Every year when Truman comes out, soft as the sea I go. I had no chance of being on them, partly because I didn't have any discernible talent, but partly because I was just ugly looking. Mind you, thinking back on it, that never really stopped a lot of people.
Yeah, I want that shirt. I want the cock shirt.
Next up, the ITV series that was one of the cruelest practical joke shows ever.
God, my heart skipped a beat when fucking Private Dicks came up.
Great Yarmouth, a day by the seaside. In this hotel, Trevor and Julia Gibson are about to come down for breakfast on the third day of their honeymoon. What Trevor doesn't know is that the attractive blonde at the table next to him knows an awful lot about him, including the fact that he likes having his feet tickled.
Hi, how are you? Fancy seeing you here. How's your team, Billy? All right? I think you'll like having your feet tickled, do you? So anyway, lovely seeing you.
Bye. Oh.
In the burning aftermath of Saturday Night Fever, every man around the world wanted to be the next John Travolta. ITV raked through the ashes and gave us the World Disco Dancing Championships.
I don't actually remember anyone dancing like that. Any bloke dressed like that, hopping around, smiling, right, in Reading, would last about 2 minutes. He'd never dance again.
Soon they're gonna reach the top. Clippity-clop, clippity-clippity-clippity, clippity-clippity-clippity-clop. Now, they say variety is dead. The question is, was it novelty acts like this that killed it? Memories of some really weird variety performances, like Bob the Tray at number 36.
What an act! Get along,
mule! Get along. I used to do that with a dustbin lid.
We end this long stretch with a hysterical Aussie soap sent down. It's Prisoner Cell Block H, a knitting needle in the back of serious drama. But that was on the outside.
tell everybody to get ready. And things were different
then. It was one of them shows that was so bad it became a cult show. It was like badly written, very poorly acted, almost of a Neighbours standard.
I really hate him so much.
And I think that's why people took it to their hearts.
Oh, I thought I'd let
more
you hit
private
me from
dicks.
Behind.
Yeah, we'll do a private dick stream. We'll do private dicks, star, naked attraction. All the big ones. Ah. Ah. Amazing acting.
What I
Eurotrash, good
Prison
shout.
Cell Block H was the fact that Australians had recognised that lesbians exist.
All right, who's next?
We had a great sort of beefy.
I thought that was her. I thought it was the woman.
Jail, vicious bullies. We had prison wardens with brilliant nicknames like Vinegar Tits. We had women behaving very badly.
Fucking hell, sorry, that tickled me. Vinegar Tits!
Oddly enough, like Neighbours, occasionally very moving, very tender moments.
Oh, sorry.
Are you got me that satisfied?
One. See, you laugh. You see,
next ad break, I'm going to have to go for a Jimmy
you
Piss,
know,
I'm afraid.
I used to present the Late Show live.
Vinegar Tits!
About 12:15. Knowing that Prisoner Cell Block H was on the other side, you know, I felt terribly torn because I was presenting live The Late Show and knowing that really the audience was elsewhere watching Prisoner Cell Block H and I wanted to be there too, you know. But the roses
here are prisoners too. All that lovely prison disco lighting that they had. I might give that a watch, you know.
For those
right,
who just tuned in,
guys, I will be back in just a moment. right, I'll leave you with something to watch. I've got an idea for something that you guys might like, actually, because I got this this Casio keyboard the other day, and essentially, I've been composing this. Been composing this this theme of a famous wrestler called John Cena, and it says 5 years ago, but that's just a YouTube error. That it was actually composed just a couple of weeks ago, and I've done the shit before, so you know what's coming, and you've got this for about 2 minutes while I have a piss, wash my hands, and think about what I've put myself in for this evening with this fucking stream. See you in a minute. I didn't think I was going to need another piss, but I did need another piss, so it's not unreasonable. If I want to piss, I'll have a piss. So right, we're getting back to it. Hope you guys are enjoying the as much as you can the show so far. What do you mean thank fuck for that? Need to get a new keyboard. Need to get a new keyboard song, right? Well, no, I'm quite proud of that, actually. Need to get a new keyboard song, right? Oh, echo again. Lost like 30 viewers. Never mind. Never mind. Well, if you don't appreciate my art, then don't watch. Back to the horrible racism
stuff.
Counting
down at the top, almost. You know, these. And then, after that, it's surrounded by the soft gauze filter of nostalgia. But we all know what old TV was really like, don't we?
Chugs Raid. I fucking hope not. We are down to number 34.
From Norwich, it's the quiz of the week.
At 34, the quiz with paltry prizes straight from a car boot sale and a presenter from Norwich who made Alan Partridge look positively caring.
There were two problems with Sailor of the Century. One was that it was an idea and a format imported
from America, you little cunt.
Where members of the public competing for prizes was a major part of American television. I mean, famously in the expression that still survives, the $64,000 question.
Welcome once again to the Sale of the Century.
Now, the problem with bringing those to Britain was that there were very, very strict rules on the level of prizes that you could give away.
Here's a £7.14 luxury kitchen cutlery set, a bargain at 95 pence.
So in most of the quiz and game shows, and Sailor of the Century is a good example, the prizes tended to be very tacky.
And you can get the fun out of the snowy weather with this £5.90 toboggan with steel runners, yours for 90
pence. Even at 6 quid.
There's another problem, which is that TV critics always sneer at quiz shows.
Where's the bank account?
And it's because they tend to think of themselves as being very clever, intellectual people. And what they always say is, those stupid people didn't know that Shakespeare wrote Hamlet.
Who wrote the novel Tess of the D'Urbervilles? Tess of the D'Urbervilles.
Look at the prizes. 4 Thomas quid, Hardy, 22 quid, 21 quid.
I was under tremendous pressure from the producer to always keep going irrespective. He wanted to treat it as a live show.
It's the very latest 1972 model.
Is that
now, can you push the door and get out?
Other shows,
if something went get wrong, out. Is that him?
Gaff or you asked the wrong question, or you tripped over your words.
Is it? Fucking hell. Looks like a different bloke.
It's called, and go again.
Women sometimes have their hair
cut.
Oh,
yeah, so it is.
No. Who wrote a symphony, number 6 in F, called The Pastoral?
I made a mistake.
12 quid, 10 quid, 14 quid, glass.
And keep moving, which must have made me look a little bit more of a sort of quiz automaton than a human being.
Elizabeth, have you got a mink coat?
No.
Would you like to earn a mink coat, Elizabeth? Would you like to earn a mink coat, Elizabeth?
She doesn't know where she
Come
is.
Come on, say, would you like to earn a mink
Come
coat?
Come on, say it.
Not enough minks for that.
People always say, why was Sale of the Century so successful? Well, I don't know. The public are drawn to a show. They like it. The public are what makes it. It doesn't matter what the critics say.
Tune in at the same time next week. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye.
12 years. That's the grand prize. The
we
golf.
Have a model here.
Yeah.
And
Andrew.
Well, show us how
and,
you
Andrew.
By,
well, basically, I look at the shape of the bottom and the lines under the cheek.
This nutter, she does bloody, what's it called, rumpology? Where
I pick up that she's quite happy-go-lucky.
It's all right, there's underwear on.
Also, looking for a change in career as well.
How?
she reads people's bums, right?
The career sort of thing is here.
She reads people's bums and tells their future from the bottom.
Instead, we go back to the original plans and examine how it's taken.
She was on
DIY
a Shirley Ghostman with Mark
Whitton.
They call it bumology.
DIY shows now are all rag rolling and stippling.
Smiley, smiley, Carol, smiley.
Sort of modern and hedonistic.
Yes, you can read my bum at the end of the stream. I will be getting the bum out, and if you can fill me in on my future.
Hello,
excuse me, my
and
future.
Welcome once again. Well, if that's not enough to confuse her, I don't know what is.
I did this, I don't know whether you were watching when I built a refrigerator.
Playing about with paint, I think is fun, and if you're interested, it's quite nice to do this sort of treatment.
Everything had to be functional in the 60s and 70s.
Hello. I want to talk about helmets this week.
But if you look at their ideal homes on things like Barry Bucknell and whatever those other early 70s ones were called. Everything ends up looking like an East German military installation.
I don't know whether you've got a problem like this, a rather ugly old panel door.
Lick a paint, that'll look lovely. What are you on about?
Quite simply, you can make it look like this.
It was basically
sand it,
all
give it
about
a varnish.
Art
oh, fucking hell, he's ruined the door.
Destroy any personality it had.
And you can do that.
It looks horrible.
A sheet of cardboard right over the door.
His trousers are up there as well. I just noticed his trousers are right above his fucking vinegar tits.
Oh my god!
I love it or hate it. One or the other. I don't like it.
I don't like it.
No.
No slip into the cesspit of TV moments would be complete without a flurry of Eurovision failures and the hell that Norway puts itself through year after year. Hey, oh, lole, 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 lole,
lole. Hey, oh, lole, 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 lole. It's that guy's face that's got me there. Nilpois.
Kids Timmy Hammer.
What the fuck?
Well, some are anyway. But only a decade ago, wacky men.
Why was
and
this so popular as well? Timmy Mallet, I know we've been Timmy asking this a lot place. Today, but. What? This?
Hello, Waterwakers!
Next, second helpings of two persistent.
Oh, he's back. John Lydon's back.
It's Johnny Rotten against the world again when he turns up on
Adam, can we get
story?
The changing room teapot episode? It's a pure British classic. What, where she smashes all the shit? Yeah, if I can find the full episode.
The first juror.
One day we'll do like a clip show as well. I know we're doing a clip show now.
Johnny Rotten did it, actually. It was an unusual thing for him to have done. Sure, what?
Remember then, didn't make it to the 20. They don't think that one's going to make it at all. And here is record number two.
I like this song.
That ain't the Donna Summers I know. I hate it. It's awful.
where do you think she's changed?
It was mediocre. Full stop.
But if it's not the Donna Summer that you knew,
I mean,
in what
come
way
on, I don't deserve no more comment than that.
As I say it now, what clearly is that of all the people on the show,
he's so fed up. Why has he got booked on there?
He's the most realistic. He's
after his first time on TV,
I
guess.
Actually,
I think a singing has tremendous merits.
If you know Johnny Rotten's on there, people are going
to
tune in.
She was trying to say,
and then obviously something snapped, and that kind of, you know, that kind of
maybe we get away with it. But I think watching old Eurovision would be class. Yeah, I don't know if we would, just because all the songs will be content ID'd, won't they? I don't think we would.
Normally, I wouldn't listen to it. It's patronising rubbish.
Yeah. Alan? Well, actually, I was surprised.
They're all
that
fucking
Johnny
smoking as well. Have
really
you noticed in so many
career,
of these clips? They've all got a cigarette lit up.
Yes, 4 years ago. Big
yes,
difference.
That's fine. Four years ago, that's fine, John. And I'm quite sure that you're very proud of what you did 4 years ago. And I'm sure that these boys are equally as proud as what they've done here in 1979.
But it's a fascinating moment when you see him tell Johnny Rotten to shut up.
I think one of the great pities on this particular record.
Great TV.
For me, the whole performance of Johnny Rotten is all to do with the eyes. The way he would look at Noel Edmonds is eventually how an entire nation would look at Noel Edmonds.
Yeah, fair as well.
Over the next few weeks to see how much the local radio listeners disagree with our jury here. And I hope it wasn't too exciting for Johnny Rotten, who seems to have taken the whole thing.
Good night.
He's gone off to a previous engagement.
At 28, we award red cards in an early bath to the footballers who should have stuck to playing their own field.
Oh, Glenn Hoddle.
And none more so than Glenn Hoddle and Chris Waddle on
Chris Waddles. I haven't seen this.
At number 27, the quiz show that pitted New European against New European. Well, as long as they could speak our lingo anyway. Hold on a minute. Doesn't that give us an advantage?
Who am I? I am an author, mathematician and photographer born in England in 1832. I produced two of the most famous books in English literature. One of them was written to amuse a little girl named Alice Liddell.
Alice in Wonderland.
Scotland.
Lewis
Carroll. Sorry,
Lewis Carroll is correct. Scotland, you're in the first round.
Anyway, at least Henry Kelly led the way in breaking down those centuries-old stereotypes.
Well, our successful contestant...
He's a big lad, isn't he, Jacob?
Jacob Mayer, Jacob. Do you Jacob, wear
sorry.
Clogs by any chance, Jacob, no?
Not nowadays.
And now the TV show that did more for republicanism than Fergie's toe-sucking
Stuart
exploits.
Hall.
Yes, the royal experts say this was a turning point in how we saw the monarchy.
It's a Knockout had basically had its day by the time It's a Royal Knockout.
We did watch an episode of It's a Knockout.
Last-ditch attempt to inject some excitement into what was becoming a tired formula.
Fergie.
In quite a clever coup, they did it by humiliating the royal family.
As I approach Her Royal Highness the Princess Royal with some trepidation, ma'am. Where are your tactics?
Oh, very cool, calm, collected.
Very, very cool.
I think it's a shame none of the bigger royals did it. I think it's a shame Di didn't do it, and Charles, and the Queen, and the Duke of Edinburgh. That would have been really worth watching.
Well, maybe they were in some of the larger suits.
He's great, Buxton.
They've got to be caught to catch the flowers, first of all.
There's no chance they'd do this now, is there?
Flindell's going to be caught. She's caught. Let the losers take comfort
fucking
in the thought
that Atkinson
they will
again.
Never, ever look so foolish again.
This is another in our very popular series, Interviews with Drunken Rock Stars. But here, Wayne Hussey from The Mission, and he's celebrating because, listen, you're doing well, aren't you? Number one, what in the charts?
I don't fucking know.
I don't fucking know. Never heard him.
Which camera's on?
Can you carry on with that?
Yeah,
look after that, just a moment.
All right.
Wayne, look, I've got. Hang on, just a minute. Just a minute. Wayne.
Just a minute.
Hang on, just a minute, Wayne.
He's cunted.
I've got something to show you. I want to show you. Come here, come here, Wayne.
He's absolutely wanked, isn't he?
No, Wayne.
And a twat.
Wayne, come over here. Over here, Wayne.
Just taking care of what happens over here.
He's gone.
One moment, just. Pop him outside the door.
He's not going to leave, is he?
Oh, okay. Another year.
Yeah, that's going to work, isn't it? Leave him outside the door.
No, wait, just stay over here. Roll VT and.
Fuck off! QVC? Whoa, it's a personal attack now.
Who would probably get overexcited spending half an hour with the latest.
I can take all the racism and sexism and everything else, but. Making fun of QVC? Outrageous.
And on they'll go for hours. Oh, I'll just finish off. I'll just leave that on the pashmina
Oh, that is a nice set.
The thing I love about QVC
sarong
is
and scarf. That is a
names.
Nice set.
Diamond
let me tell
QVC's
you.
QVC's most popular simulated
Diamondique.
It's not gold. It's goldet. Or they're not diamonds. They're diamantre.
That would look lovely.
They're not wrong.
With the Tintique or anything. The other chain that we
yes,
have.
Yes, absolutely. All the emeraldique studs.
Yes, or the antique eek Byzantine rings.
Absolutely. Or the ruby eek. Or even just with eek.
It's a rather well-kept secret. People don't like admitting that they watch it.
This is the Puffini and Clipfini hairstyling set.
People ring in and you hear sort of Enid from Horsham. And you think, yeah, she hasn't got any friends. She's just like me.
It's for my son.
Right.
It's for your son. And what is he going to use it for?
Well, he wants to try to... He's got some tattoos on his arm.
Ah, okay. It will cover tattoos.
But I find that for those moments in your life where...
The Canadian Outlaw, you know, thank you so much. Brand new subscriber really there. Much appreciated, mate.
You watch the Shopping Channel and you know that
I feel
it
attacked by this.
Great to meet
is
you.
Is that it? Are we finished?
See you next time, maybe.
Oh, couldn't you give me another hour?
Well, here I am in my home, and before I take the drug, Dr. Osmond's got one or two quite unrehearsed questions, I've no idea what they are, to put to me.
Right, Christopher.
Carry on.
Could you tell me the date today, please?
Well, I'm feeling perfectly fit at the moment, and as sane as I ever am, and I'll take the drug now.
TV presenter in drugs hell caught on camera. Not a screaming headline, but Panorama reporter Chris Mayhew being filmed taking hallucinogenic drugs.
Fuck.
And back again. And I'm not so conscious, Humphrey, of removing myself in space.
What a pro. Conscious. What a pro. LSD.
Of moving in time.
What a pro. He's doing better than me after a fucking single coke there. Adam, thank you so much for the sub, mate. Cheers.
TV, really. It was a gag. It was good fun.
What's this?
See, the cliche in television circles goes, well, we haven't got a lot of money, but actually that's very liberating because that means we can use our imaginations. bollocks. If you ain't got a lot of money, you got crap television.
We are Britain's first 24-hour cable station, and we're the channel that are going to bring you the stars, the stories, the
absolutely
gossip,
fucking
and the
loving
views
the
that
shit,
you care
Treacle.
About.
Thank you.
Didn't
thank
see
you,
much
Oliver.
Point replicating Panorama. We neither had the intellect.
Taking
or the
drugs?
Cash
is he about
to
write for Raw?
Our
Matt,
own
what
route.
You like? What you
and
like?
Our own route involves such television classics as Topless.
Yeah,
Darts.
We'll do an LSD stream
welcome
next
to
week.
Topless
Andrew,
at the
what?
Ballet.
Oh shit. Andrew? Andrew?
This really is
Andrew? Thank you for that. Good lad, Andrew. Sergeant Pacitti earning his money today.
News Bunny. Quite a funny idea, but by week two, the costume was falling apart and they couldn't replace it.
Bill Clinton faces further embarrassment today as more sordid details of his sex life were exposed in Monica Lewinsky's testimony.
He reveals an encounter with the president while he was using crutches for a stiff knee. Nobody was ever going to sit down and say, oh, do you know what, I'm going to put my TV on for a couple of hours. But some of the ideas...
The news, Bunny! The fucking amazing! What?
Hello, yes, it's me, your bouncer's weatherman, Rusty Goff. Brr! Yes, it is still cold because the cold, chilly winds are still with us.
Then he'd get up to Birmingham like that. He'd really have to bounce to get up like that.
Up in the Midlands, though, it's clearer skies, but possibly showers, but still remaining cool.
And he could just about get to Edinburgh, right? And then he'd be done for.
Up in Scotland, though, although there's a frost in Argyll, it's the best chance of sun. But there's still a bit of wind, and temperatures only getting to 16 degrees Celsius.
So anybody who watched it, hoping to find out...
Vince McMahon is going to nick this idea.
He couldn't bounce high enough to get it, right? And on one occasion, he went boom to give it a special go to get up to Fife, right? He went boom, bang. He just about fingered Fife. Lost
just about fingered Fife.
And live on TV.
We've all
shot
been
off
there.
The, shot off the trampoline.
Here's your bouncer's weather forecast, Rusty Goff, signing off.
It was much more like if you take your kids to the circus. It was fantastic. Oh. Glamorous women walking around.
Oh, Andrew.
Very small people wandering around. Huge, tall people wandered around. People wearing exotic stuff. You know, it was great.
Over the last 5 years, we've thoroughly enjoyed making programmes for you. We've had a
Sergeant Pacitti and the rest of the stream is the laugh I needed today. Thank you, Stephen. What's this?
It's a one-line joke, isn't it? It's a funny idea in a kind of cheesy
breaking news. WWE announced the signing of indie wrestler Vinegar Tits. He will be joining up with Retribution. That's Ricochet.
After that, you've got to throw some quality at the screen, which is why whenever people talk about TV nightmares, they've got to talk about live TV.
Someone get Pacitti and News Bunny ASAP. TV we need that, don't we? Fucking hell, that was amazing. Also, I met Rusty Jeff a few
in
years
fact,
ago.
With
lovely
so
bloke.
Many
and
channels
very
around
funny.
These days. The potential. Hey,
there he is. He's over his fuck. The News Bunny. I love the News Bunny.
On. See you after the break.
Rabbiting on. Get it. Get it.
Please don't have nightmares.
There he is. Thanks to you and the guys for helping get me interested in pro wrestling, watching some old pay-per-views, catching up on what I've missed. Our pleasure. Canadian Outlaw, thank you so very much. Cheers for the bits.
Welcome back, my friends, to the hell that never ends. And what does it say about our TV nation that we get more
I knew this was
going
to be a controversial one to watch. But some of this has even come as a surprise to me.
Do we really treasure Naked Jungle more than the naked?
No, please, no.
The more
no.
Of us yearn for Why Don't You than Doctor
Who? Of course, Naked
Just
Jungle's going to be on
there. Just ponder these imponderables while I stoke the fire.
Andrew,
with
get
the
Sergeant Pacitti ready.
Of Benny Hill.
Amazing green screen effect there.
At number 21, we see how real crime can sometimes penetrate the safe haven of TV. And none so shocking than when it destroys our childhood innocence.
It was such a fine moment when Blue Peter music came on and there were the presenters and it was Janet Ellis who sat there so solemn and so grave and so sincere and tells the viewers at home that the Blue Peter garden has been vandalised.
First, though, we've got some rather bad news.
I hear about this
raid,
all the time still.
This morning,
despite the fact it happened
weekend,
5 years before I was born.
Broke into the
this
Blue
was
Peter
huge.
And caused rather a lot
as
of damage.
As big as the elephant pooing
the
on the floor.
Blue Peter garden vandalism was one of my favourite moments ever growing up. Janet Ellis just had to be so serious.
And one really cruel thing they did was to pour fuel oil into the fish pond. Well, we've drained the pond and we've rescued some of the fish, but a few of them have died and the oil itself has caused a lot of damage.
That is a pretty fucking shitty thing to do.
The lovely urn given to us by Mr. Taylor from so-and-so.
The vandals then broke our lovely ornamental urn given to us by Mr. Taylor from Barnet. They then smashed up our sundial and then callously threw it into the pond.
Oh, that's pretty horrible stuff.
On the bedding plants as well.
Of course it wasn't enough. I mean, this idea of vandals going, OK, stop, that's like, leave the flowers. I love the juxtaposition.
Well, we have to repair the damage, and we may even be able to repair the ornamental urn.
What about that's the flowers, good. Boss? Trample them. What about this? What is it? It's the urn given to him by Mr. Taylor. Smash it.
But it's very sad to think that a few people take such pleasure from harming their fellow human beings and from hurting animals as well.
Oh,
school was laughing there.
Ricky's very good on this.
It was the next fucking day. Fucking hell! Just the talk of the yard because it was.
I'm
the
just going to pause it for a second. I think you've seen what's happened there, Faustino, mate. Thank you so much. I'm going to read every fucking name. We're taking a break from all the racism and oil in the fish pond and all that. Thank you. What a fucking legend. Thank you. Pocket Sand, Ugly Bob, Deadly Darrow, V. Victus Omen, Samster, Death Scythe, Brian, Barbara, Phineas, My Name Is Not Flo, Ran, Vaspel, iPro, Harry, Don Boy, Tangerine One, Muggy, Linguini Meanie, fantastic username, Magix, Kiers, Tower 51, Andy Gold, SNK, Sir Waffles, Awkward Slinky, Atlas, Stuart the Coder, Yakka Prime, Alex, Foxeye, Robot Pluto, Stingray, Cook the Ant, Timber Panic, Kalaka Booter, Notorious PIP, War, The Real Rob Lowe 420, Margaret Thatcher is dead, Robocop Sanchez, Ready Steady Mex, Adrenalize, JC the Destroyer, Jimmy Scrambles. That caught me off guard, sorry. Oh. Jack John plays games, JC, Brody Man, Hoist, SL Prawn, and Momo Bomb. Faustino, mate, thank you so much. And a big special congratulations to Margaret Thatcher is dead. Oh, I'm crying. She was my hero. It wasn't laughter. Oh, you broke me there. Fuck me. Thank you. Thank you so much. On with the show. Thank you again. Thank you.
Only my sister. My older sister sat there and went, oh, that's dreadful. That's so sad.
I wasn't expecting that at all.
Oh, shut up. This is absolutely brilliant.
And here are the survivors. It really is an absolute miracle that they have.
They rescued the fish. It's a fucking feel good story. Let's end the stream before we get some more fucking racism.
I think they're looking amazing.
Oh. Well, it's not a Red Rogue, thank you very much for the gifted sub as well. To Sam, thank you.
Oh. Terrible when you come to look at it.
Oh, top of the pot. Oh, we might be about to see Jimmy here. God, they had more than one song.
Sometimes you see stuff on the telly and you think, is there a joke there? Is it a mistake? And if so, am I missing something? And Dexys Midnight Runners, when they're at their peak and they covered Van Morrison's fantastic bomb, Jackie Wilson said.
I'm absolutely crying with laughter. I fucking love the hot mess that these streams turn into. A PC nightmare. It is, yeah. They always are. I don't know how, every time.
There's a bloody great photograph of Jackie Wilson, the dance player.
Fucking hell.
For a bit, you looked at it and you thought, they must know.
Fan.
I think because of the intensity that the old Dexys guy used to, Kevin Nolan used to give to his performance. That was what was so fantastic. The combination of his intensity and Jockey Wilson behind him. As if you finally felt he does have a sense of humor. You know? And I think my conclusion after the performance was that he isn't indeed mad beyond belief, but much shrewder and much more of a comedian.
Beautiful. And again, what a guy. He's done it. He's cleaned up there.
In 30 seconds, a brief reminder
goodness
of Bullseye.
Me. The game show. Oh, what's wrong with Bullseye? Cracker Jack. If you were lucky, you'd end up with a bendy Bowen was shit as well. Pat Sharp there on the right.
30, 40, 50, 60 pounds. Take that with our compliments.
Trip, thank you so much for the resub there. Thank you, mate.
There you are. Have your bullies. You really have been
lovely. I'd love one of those bullies.
Have a nice day with us.
Thank you, lovely. Marvellous.
That way you're going.
Wait, fuck off.
At 18, we make rude and aggressive gestures to opportunistic docu-soap stars like Maureen out of
Maureen's
antics might have driven her husband.
She was
mad,
a global superstar for like 2 months.
Docu-soap star.
She's driving in my car by madness. Song.
But at least it wasn't Jeremy from Airport.
I remember getting the preview tape and the office stopped. We watched that scene with her husband shouting at her as she's sort of veering over the dual carriageway.
Such good telly.
With mouths open, and we said, this is going to be huge. But what we didn't realise was
fucking
that
Maureen.
One programme would have spawned such a heritage of airline, airport, traffic wardens, you know.
What took me 10 minutes to go to the shop takes me nearly an hour.
Yeah.
Because I get everyone and... In my
she crashes
opinion,
her car
you mustn't
six times.
Slum everyone because they're the people that made you.
Oh! Oh,
I don't remember that.
Oh, I want your autograph. I want to see what Maureen's autograph looks like.
Andy Warhol said,
oh, look at her lovely outfit as well. Bless her.
Certainly true of this. Just
she's class.
The box does turn you into some sort of
Michaels, I love how absolutely bollocks these streams are. You're amazing, Adam. Thanks for killing me, mate. Love you. Love you too. Thank you, mate.
Next thing we'll be making shows about people making docu-soaps. I think it's very, very odd and not funny and not good. It shouldn't be allowed. All the cleaning ladies in Britain are going, soon it'll be me. All the people who work, I'm just waiting for them to film people going to the lavatory. That's my next one. It'll be called Plop Flush Clothes.
That's like a monkey dust sketch, isn't it? Celebrities on the toilet.
Stars from airport doing a poo. And you'd be going, oh, I would watch that. I probably would watch
you
that.
Would. You would watch that. Santa Claus is coming
to town. Next up, it's Mind Your Language time
again.
Here we
go. I was meant to talk about this.
As we see the nightmare star on TFI Friday, who just can't help his runaway mouth. No, not Chris Evans.
TFI Friday had just started, and we were going out live at 6 o'clock on a Friday. And we'd had Sean Ryder on the third or fourth show, just with Black Grape, and we'd interviewed him. And as part of an enticement, Chris said on air to him...
You know that you swear a lot, don't you? You are aware of that.
Yeah. If you promise not to swear, I'll give you my shoes. And he produced his shoes and put them on the table.
Would you like these shoes?
I'd find somewhere to wear them, yeah.
And Sean went, no, I promise I'll try.
Hang on. You're Patrick Cox, man, and Patrick's a fucking good...
So about 4 weeks later, we decided we wanted to have Black Grape back on singing Pretty Vacant, and we wanted to interview Sean. We were told we couldn't. So what we did was we came up with this idea that we'd pretend that we were stars in your eyes.
Who are you going to be for us?
I'm going to be Johnny Rotten.
So we pre-recorded our little bit there, and we knew it was fine. And then Sean appeared through a smoky door, waving, came out onto the audience gantry live, at which point we were at his mercy. All hell broke loose. Oh, he's gripped up. And the blood slowly drained from our face.
Well, don't let him do it then. Are you having a laugh? Of course he was gonna. What? Chris Evans' face.
Chris just had this fixed grin of a condemned.
Oh,
man.
This is the sorry, we're sorry, we're sorry, we're sorry.
We're sorry, we're sorry, we're sorry, we're sorry, we're sorry. We're very, very, very sorry.
They knew that was gonna happen. What were you fucking expecting?
As we know from the Great Storm of 87, weathermen aren't always the best at making
predictions. Oh, shit, Andrew.
Fred can be excused for not expecting this sudden appearance.
Attention! There we go. Good lad. Good lad.
Right. Quite unexpected. Over the southern part of Britain.
Good job. There he is.
Oh, no.
Bravo.
No, come on. It's human flesh. It's normal.
Oh, he's so Partridge. So Partridge. Human slayer, it's normal. Oh, he's cupping. That's all right. That's all right. Nothing.
Do you want the clipboard?
Ooh. Oh, little Sergeant Pacitti.
Round of applause for the streaker, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, fucking amazing.
At number 15, it's the most ridiculous comeback in the history of television. When Dallas Hartthrob Ewing got knocked down and wiped out,
is this the first non-British show? We haven't had this.
So a year later, he popped up in the shower, and the whole of the last series was written off as just a dream.
Oh, yeah.
Good morning.
Wife Pam may have been relieved, but the rest of us were dumbfounded.
I've been to the ranch. What's it called? The Ram Ranch. What was it called?
Whenever the story of trash TV is told, in the beginning is the word. The notorious Friday night show that took youth TV to
a new
level.
What was it? What was it?
And few items proved lower than a spot for the hopefuls.
The Double Cross Ranch. Neverland. No.
Well, I take this tubing, I stick it in my nose, it goes all the way to my stomach.
A lot of the times it wasn't too hard to be appalled at what was going on, but it was so outrageous as well that you know, personally, I just wanted to keep watching people do it.
We pump the beer into my stomach, and then we pull it back out and let members of the audience drink the bile beer.
It was really my job.
It's all green!
Oh, no, I can't believe you're doing that! While kind of going, yeah, keep it going.
Southwark Ranch. That's it, yeah.
We're going to have some bile beer brewed up.
Oh, no! Fuck that. Come on.
After I left the word, I noticed with some amusement that all the kind of the most yuck things that I used to compare in the studio kind of metamorphosized into the hopefuls.
Welcome to the hopefuls, people who said they'd do anything to get on television.
We're constantly getting letters from
great
people saying,
great idea for a show.
I'd do anything to be on telly. Get me on your show.
I genuinely think that's a really good idea for a show.
So we set him a keep fit challenge. And we finally thought, we've got this great pool of losers and deadbeats and show-offs. How can we exploit and humiliate them? As the show went on, it became coarser.
Fuck the sun. Don't buy the sun.
Some of those elements were completely sickeningly horrible, impossible to watch. I mean, it's vomit-inducing.
Is that worth it, getting on the time, Tom? No!
It wasn't to try and...
Did you see his wink? His attempt at a wink, which was just... Oh, for fuck's sake!
Wasn't to try and...
Must give my nana ring. Must give my nana ring as well.
Push back the boundaries of broadcasting.
Can you see his... Get back to his wink. It wasn't a wink, it was just a big old wink.
Time, Tom.
As if that's the worst thing. He can't wink. Oh, he can't wink, let's make fun of him. Watch him get off with an OAP now.
It was partly so everybody else sitting at home on a Friday evening, they hadn't pulled, they weren't quite drunk enough, they had to get up for work in the supermarket tomorrow morning, but could sit there thinking, I may be at a low ebb, but I'm not as sad as those fuckers.
I don't really think the TV.
Good luck for the future, mate. I've already told you, I believe it's high time that you selected a trade.
I thought you'd already picked one for me.
Because you seem incapable of it yourself.
Remember those weird children's dramas you used to watch when you came home from school? They didn't make sense, but you couldn't quite work out why. Well, here's why.
He is. It was dumb TV at its worst. Andrew on point with Sergeant Pacitti. Yes, thank you again, Andrew, mate.
It's an extraordinary waste of money to bother to dub them. Because it literally...
He's still in the chat. He's still here, Andrew. Say hello.
...of the actors' mouths at all.
Because it's a profession that disgusts me.
I'm afraid, judging my past experience, you have a tremendous disgust for work in general.
It's more distracting, because you'd sort of be looking at their lips and they'd be going, no, young man!
Right, this got like number 11 or something, because the fucking dubbing's bad. And we've had all the racism and the getting off with grannies, drinking bile.
If you look in the dictionary under the word gruff, it says, like
mini
all the
pops,
men spoke
and we
in
got...
all of those dubbed TV programs.
You know what it's like there? It's rotten. Being used to their last drop of blood.
It was so unconvincing.
He's right. Glory, just like everything else.
And he's here. Is everyone it's watching? Is everyone enjoying the widgets and the machines?
Maybe the actors that did the dubbing were just
we are, good
laugh.
Job, pal.
I'm going, let's see how little we can make it... sound as if it's coming out of their mouth.
I can't believe that.
Just for a second, imagine you're the new Welsh secretary
well.
At a televised party conference. And to your horror, you're required to sing along to your adopted national anthem. But you haven't had time to learn the words. Never mind. Surely you can just wing it somehow.
There's more than a little Mr. Bean about this bloke, isn't there? Smashed it, mate. Nobody noticed. Adam, I just wanted to say all the streams are great, but they really helped me lately. Really give me something to smile about. You and Andrew are smashing, mate. Bless you. Thank you so much, mate. Thank you.
At number 11, it's Eldorado.
Eldorado!
Eldorado, I think, was one of the BBC's most expensive.
Cost a fucking fortune, yeah. Yeah.
Estimated about 10 million quid, 2 million on the set alone. It was launched with such a hoo-ha, really. It was, you know, sun, sea, sex and sangria.
I saw the first episode and I nearly died. I thought it was ghastly.
Another beer, Annie.
I had always visualised Eldorado as a upmarket, beautiful girls, sunny beaches, big yachts, a glamorous sort of Dallas style.
I don't recognise any of the actors.
I just knew that it was going to be a good... It had to be good. You know, all it had to have was good characters, good storylines.
Oh, Trish, what happened?
Well, I know it's normally me that gets plastered, but this time it was my foot.
You've got a primetime soap. And not only have you got a very extended cast, a lot of those cast are from different countries, and they're speaking in their own language.
And there was a boy in there. Who was it?
It's like, excuse me, what? I'll go and put the kettle on.
10 million quid.
You pig.
Oh, look. It's hubby.
Terrible acting.
The Beeb said that the British working class like working class soaps. So they completely changed it to a group of people that I don't think really actually exists down here.
In short, I think you'd be best out of it. I'll go and hand in your notice tomorrow.
Look, Bunny Charlson, husband or no husband, I don't need your permission or anyone else's permission to let me work in that supermarket.
They brought in a lot of actors that were basically hadn't done very much.
What do you think?
Hello?
You can have realism if you've got time to improvise.
What do you think?
And I'm sure those actors with time, but a soap doesn't give you time. You've got to be a professional.
I love this
song. Look at the first 6 weeks.
Not enough to learn the words, obviously.
The critics went for it in the most alarming manner. And I think they just do that. They need something to go for. And I think you just have to kind of ride it out and say, OK, nothing's going to be perfect at the beginning.
Looks dreadful,
but,
in fairness.
Let's go along with it. And gradually you iron out these problems.
What was this? Was this...
Let me get this straight.
This
we're
number
leaving
11.
Spain just
was
like
this
that?
Number 10?
Yes. And we're going back to England?
Yes.
All of us?
Yes.
156 episodes isn't a terrible run by any means, though, is it? In fairness.
We're going home for good just as soon as we can.
Would it have been
3 million's
successful?
A great rating. Not back
longer?
In the day, though.
Well,
not when this
really
was airing.
Knows, but certainly the figures were growing.
Spectacular.
I mean, when after the show closed down and we used to have the tourists come up to see the set, we practically used to get attacked. Why did you stop the show? Why? I mean, people were sort of very, very bitter about it.
I'd know, Pilar. You can't trust anyone these days, can you?
Go on, give her a kiss. Oh, wish she was an old woman. Adios, Eldorado.
At this point, let's step back from the abyss for just a sec.
Right, we're skipping through
loins.
Zoe Ball's shite. We've got half an hour left, everybody.
No one can return.
How am I doing for time? I'm doing all right.
Welcome back. And begin our top.
We are in the top 10. Number 10.
We begin our top 10 with a game show that was full of baffling questions. And to think, no one asked
three,
the most
two,
obvious
one,
of the
nope.
lot.
Three,
what
two,
was
one.
It that made us all tune
Don't do
it
the other way around.
The most unfathomable programme in the entire world, 3, 2, 1. And brilliant for that.
Dusty Bin. Oliver, just demolished a box of celebrations. What are you leaving alone in the box? No Snickers or bounties for me, Treacle. I'm leaving the bounties, everything else I can get behind.
Uno, dos, tres. And anything from
one of the favourites. Everybody loves the Maltesers. I love proper Maltesers.
Great
but those Maltesers
in
celebrations.
3-2-1.
3-2-1.
I was watching The Incredible Hulk the other day and he came on and went.
These awful kind of, you know, here's my sexy secretaries.
Right now I meet my gorgeous secretaries. Here they are, the gentle sex.
There's these girls and they're kind of posed with notepads and glasses, you know. Oh, yeah, because glasses make you look intelligent, don't they?
I want you to give me the letters of the alphabet backwards, starting, of course, with Z. All right? Letters of the alphabet backwards, starting from Z. I will give you one
Z,
for a pound.
Y.
Z.
X.
X. No. What was most unfathomable was,
oh, got it wrong.
Was the questions.
What's going to be the clue?
No, it's the hat. The hat. And the rhyme is, jacket and you won't get clobbered. This could be for collection. It's appropriate for spring, but do you need protection?
The people who cracked
the enigma.
It's a
very British
code,
thing,
I
isn't
think,
it? Like, oh, men dressing up as women, that's funny. Question.
Johnny Logan has just brought you an
And even recently we've seen that. Like, Little Britain wasn't that long ago.
With a minimum of thought.
Come Fly With Me did it as well. Basically anything with Matt Lucas in it.
The booby won't get caught.
My first is in dustbin, but never in lid. My second's in saucepan. You won't find me in kid. Look out the alley, look up the valley. What am I, Ted? Do not dally. What the fuck is that ever going to mean to anybody?
You'll think the rhyme may not be fair. Well, perhaps this is a house in Mayfair. But no, even 3-2-1 couldn't afford one of those. What? With a minimum of thought. So if you think more than a minimum, the rhyme will be fair.
What?
What?
And so may be the prize.
Carry I on agree,
the
Kate.
Started, the booby won't get caught.
What?
That's another hint that this isn't the booby prize. What about the frilly parasol in a song? There was somebody
Mrs.
else...
Mrs. Brown, yeah, good shout, Sean.
Bonnet Mayfair.
What?
Forgot about that.
What?
Minimum, can't say I've been keeping up.
Carry on
I did see that it's been renewed
it's
for five seasons, or 5 years.
You sat at home going,
and it has
no.
to air on Christmas
Do
Day,
you understand
prime
the question,
time.
Ted?
I think it was 10 p.m.
Jesus.
Maybe 9.
Let's go and meet this little
That's in the contract. Dog shit.
This show
what?
On Saturday night, and you'd be sitting there.
Dusty bin as well. What the fuck
the
is that about?
Costume drama, the BBC. Snooker on BBC Two. Oh no, it's 3-2-1.
3-2-1. Good night, everybody. Bye.
Goodness me. Number 9.
At number 9, we try to get into the heads of the producers who replace the actors playing some of our favourite soap characters and hope
well,
we
that's
won't
a glow
notice
up
the
there,
difference.
Isn't it?
Well, the other characters don't seem to.
She looks a bit like a Philomena Kunk on the left there. It's gonna have to be a
different man. There's a pernicious disease in soap.
Too much soap stuff. I don't watch soaps. I don't understand any of this.
Often accompanied by complete memory loss of all your friends and family. I can see that the girl is... Gail Platt's one of the worst offenders. What sort of mother doesn't notice that her children have been changed mysteriously in the night by aliens? Sarah Lou was changed because Teen O'Brien was brought in to do the teenage pregnancy storyline.
No, she isn't. I want to get Gail. This back.
And Adam Rickett
Pete
was
Dunn,
brought
who looked
in,
like
not
Pete
only
Dunn,
did his head
Gail
change,
Platt.
He had an entirely different body.
It's got Joyce in it.
So he went upstairs, a young adolescent boy, and came back down a sex god.
Oh, you've filled out, you have.
Yes.
Well, some things never change.
In Emmerdale,
pumping away
Sarah
upstairs.
Sutton changed her head. Alison Spiro was brought in.
That's it, isn't it? The villain there. Changing actors is definitely
Jack
worse than racism. It's
the
mental, isn't it?
Jack
the ordering of this.
Young Ben Freeman was brought
completely
in as a
perplexing.
Sexier version of Scott Windsor to replace Toby Cockerell. And Toby didn't take it too well because a couple of weeks after he was axed, I saw him at the Royal Shakespeare Company production of
Julius
Caesar.
How can it get worse than Minnie Pops?
And he was Mrs. Caesar. In a frock.
This certainly isn't. Number 9. They changed some actors. Number 76. The
Are the girls
series
really
ever
streets
seen.
Ahead of the boys in terms of education?
Oh, it's the shite
so,
University Challenge
the
team
underperforming
that, like,
undergraduates
basically
who
no
this
questions
appearance
right.
On University Challenge.
Hi, I'm Rachel Coleman. I'm from Christian Mulford in Wiltshire, and I'm reading Natural Sciences. Newhall isn't that well-known a college, or it wasn't then. And I thought, oh, if we go on University Challenge, we'll raise the profile. You know, maybe we'll win a few games and people will have heard of us.
Hello, I'm Rosie Shaw from Shrewsbury and I'm reading philosophy.
Yeah, young ones parodying this with...
Hi, I'm Abby Bradley.
Scumbag University, Scumbag College.
I'm reading Chemical Engineering.
I was feeling very excited and a bit nervous, I suppose, as well.
Hi, I'm Sarah Davis. I live in Oxford and I'm reading experimental psychology.
But there was a good atmosphere behind and you watched other people. In fact, the team that was filmed before us did, well, what was supposed to be really badly, and they got about 95 points. And Jeremy Paxman actually laid into them. And so we were thinking, oh, my God.
This was after the young ones. Interesting.
That. Best of luck to both teams. Fingers on the buzzer. Here's your first start of a 10.
Suddenly we were doing
What's this like mid to late 90s?
It wasn't warm up anymore. The TV cameras were rolling. And the potentially there were a lot of people watching.
Nottingham Golding.
Pekingese.
Pekingese is right. The Sunday Mail and...
Nottingham Golding.
Rupert Murdoch.
Rupert Murdoch is right.
Nottingham Quinn.
Stroboscope.
Stroboscope is right.
Quinn?
This is a starter question. Maybe you're getting this one.
Quinn or Quinn? Never
Goodness
mind.
Had nothing
Nottingham
to do
Quinn.
With... Published in 19...
Newhall Coleman.
I knew it when I hit the button and suddenly there's this red light pointing at me and I just... So I forgot.
Oh, bad luck. You lose five. Enforcement officer.
Nottingham Golding.
PC.
PC is right.
Nottingham Charler.
Melanin?
Melanin's is right. Blue Knights.
Newhall Davis.
Benny Goodman?
No, I'm afraid you lose five.
We must have looked aghast every time we got an answer wrong. And I know I got picked up.
What a love of Nottingham
quite
in the
a lot
chat.
Afterwards for being seen to be swearing beautiful place. My breath when we got answers wrong.
I'm afraid you lose 5 points. Jesus. It looks bad, Newhall, but we're not even halfway yet.
They actually stopped.
Minus 15!
We were on minus 15. That was when I thought it really can't get any better, can it?
I decided before we started filming that even if I didn't know the answer to something, if the entire question had been read out and the other team hadn't answered, it was worth pressing the buzzer and making a completely wild guess.
Which large bird
Brilliant
has
strategy
species
when
called
you're losing
saddle-billed,
points.
Marabou,
They're up to 35.
Adjutant and white, the last of which tends in Europe to nest on rooftops?
Not clear.
Newhall Shore.
Heron.
Nope. I remember getting quite upset.
I'm as bad as
her. Next to me. Just kept buzzing.
Describes
Newhall Shore.
Napkin.
No, you lose 5 points.
And kept buzzing.
Newhall Shore.
Mars.
No.
And kept buzzing.
No.
Newhall Shore.
Ben Johnson.
No.
No.
Sitting back in my chair and going, right, that's it. Lost it now.
I want to be as kind
no.
as you can, Newhall, but it's a terrible score. In fact, I think it's the worst score since University Challenge came back. In fact, I'm pretty sure it is.
I'm surprised that we've not seen Paxman with his
sit down and
with the interview where he asked the same question like 20 times or whatever it was. With oh,
you
fucking
really
hell, what's his name?
Don't expect that to happen. You don't expect to sink like
was
that.
Was he Chancellor of the Exchequer at the time? Well, what's his fucking name? Somebody
to
help
fail
me out there.
So what? Hugely. Was just even
not
more
Vampiro.
Hilarious than failing
Michael
by
Howard,
margin.
Thank you. Jesus Christ.
Everyone in the country is going to
My
see
My memory.
Bye.
Bye.
I'm thrilled to be here with you in New York on such
you
a special
haven't answered
night.
My question.
And it's even more special
oh,
because
this
it
is
just so happens to be
Jacko
someone special's birthday.
Thinking he's won an award, and it wasn't an award.
This is
it's like thanking for the Lifetime Achievement Award.
Don't want to do that impression. I consider him the artist of the millennium. So happy birthday, my friend, the King of Pop.
I loved the fact that Michael Jackson thought he'd won an award and he hadn't, because it's just one of those so kind of, fist in mouth, terribly,
so
terribly
awkward.
Embarrassing, awful
so
things.
So awkward.
I don't suppose anybody knew that a mistake had been made, because they didn't rush out and go, give us that back, you're not the artist of the millennium. Take your birthday cake and go.
If someone had told me that one day I would be getting, as a musician, the artist of the millennium award...
It wasn't an award. It wasn't an award.
You know, this was the guy...
That was for the next...
Who was the king of pop.
Actual award
and
winner.
Now he's coming up and getting awards that aren't even for him.
First, I'd like to thank God, who makes all things possible.
I'd like to thank God. I'd like to thank my parents, David Blaine...
Brittany down in a pint in the background.
The difference jokes, even the white guy.
And all the
yeah, you're not
going to
take it back, are you?
God bless you, thank you.
Maybe she got, you know, a bit of a star
cringe.
When she saw him when he came. Oh, well, you're the artist of the millennium. There you go, well done. Craig, what was I meant to say soon?
Peace out, one love. Y'all knobhead.
For some, TV can go just too close to the knuckle on occasions, and that's when all hell breaks loose, as Julian Clary found out.
Julian
Clary
is fucking hilarious here, and
the
press absolutely wrecked him for it. It didn't work for years.
I think it shows that there were two very separate groups.
And it's so funny.
Today, there's sort of the Middle England group, you know, to whom words like bloody are still offensive. And there's a whole other group that grew up you know, with Monty Python and the Young Ones and alternative comedy and all the stuff that sort of came after that, who just don't find that stuff shocking at all.
Hello, good old fisting, that's right.
Good to see you. How's it hanging?
Oh, very well, thank you. Very nice of you to recreate hamster teeth for me here.
I remember watching Julian Clear at the
Comedy Awards. Fantastic. Thinking, well, this fuck off, Gary.
There's no way this behaviour can be accepted.
As a matter of fact, I've just been fisting Norman Lamont.
It proved to me that this guy is Andy not Onucci, a mainstream entertainer and
bottom left
be
there. They're all loving it. They're all
and
loving it because it's so funny.
Very, very easily for it.
Let me ask you, Julian, talk about... Julian, talk about the red fox.
Next day, all this coverage in the papers about filthy Julian Clary.
Oh, fuck him.
How dare he insult Norman Lamont. And I thought, good grief. Is it still that offensive to say something like that in the spirit of, you know, the way it was obviously done?
He's fantastic, Julian Clary.
So how did you jump to the front of the queue then?
Just clawed my way through.
Yeah. Are we still on?
It's a fucking comedy award show. What do they want? Stephen, I watched Julian Clary when he was on Celebrity Big Brother in 2012, where he won it. I didn't know that. He came across very funny and a nice guy. He seems great, doesn't he, Steve?
What do you think?
Oh, it's the eye, isn't it?
If I were him, I wouldn't do that.
If I were him, I wouldn't do that.
How does he do that? I'm sure you're not going to tell me. Indeed. Yes, that's what I assume.
He made Eamon so uncomfortable here.
Being in a car advert, doing tricks as well. Card tricks. Excellent. Is it a trick to talk? Is it? No, it's early in the morning. I don't really care. I just want a quiet life. You know, it's 3 minutes. I just want me to talk very little.
I think Blaine's amazing for doing this.
Did you see yourself as different? In any way? I don't think about it that way. No.
It was like one of those car crash moments in live broadcasting when your palms start.
No, it wasn't. It was brilliant.
What on earth is happening?
And what do we get with you? Are you an illusionist? Are you a trickster? What is it? Are you a stuntman? What are you? How would you describe yourself?
I'm just a showman.
Yeah?
Just a showman.
Yeah. Is this part of the show? this sort of moody persona?
Everyone was talking about him. It's just a PR stunt, isn't it?
It's just you.
He did his job tremendously well.
The evil eye. The eye in the hand. And what is that? What is the eye in the hand? Let's see that again.
It's protection.
Protection. Okay. Well, at that stage, I just thought, this guy's a crackpot, basically. What does that mean?
Protection from death.
Oh.
I feel like he absolutely owned Eamon here.
Has he had too much of something he shouldn't have had? Or is he ill? And I have to say, to this day, I'm none the wiser. And is it important to you to outdo the greats like Houdini and whatever, to be more famous and more immortal than someone like Houdini?
I just like doing what I do.
This whole theory is that he was trying to hypnotise.
I wish he'd never said a
so
word.
I think he was trying something that he wouldn't admit. Either that or he's completely bonkers.
He wasn't hypnotising him.
That's
what I'm not. I'm going back to that story. That's what I'd say.
Something that he wouldn't admit. Either that or he's completely bonkers.
That's what I'd say. Nice meeting you.
I love him. I really love him.
Different.
Different. Different. Sweat. Very Alan Partridge as well.
Thinking, am I protected or not?
We're down to number 6, 5, 4. Fucking hell.
What is it about Richard Madeley that means he's played a part in so many of these TV moments from hell? Seems he just can't
stop
himself.
Okay, maybe that's all
he was
right.
Even at it on regional TV.
A lot of people hate
famous.
Him. Can't stand him, despise him, hate him.
To the third and final edition of Calendar Girls Pop. Tonight we welcome two of rock's most durable stars, Rick Parfitt and Francis Rossi,
status
quo. And someone who's kept as busy as anyone in the business, Shaken Stevens.
It's interesting to see Richard Madeley's prehistory. Obviously, he got his first television job when he was 14. Most people get a paper round.
I hear you actually like to be called Shaky.
That's right.
Why?
Well, because I shake a lot.
Well, you're sitting very, very calmly at the moment.
And one of his first jobs, it seems, was interviewing Shaken Stevens. What? Then at the very top of the entertainment tree, a Welsh Elvis Presley impersonator.
You're known really for this old style rock and roll. Why?
No, I'm basic. No, I'm a 1980s act.
Oh, yeah, of course, you're acting in the 1980s, but your style is in the roots of rock and roll, isn't it?
No, I'm not an actor.
I said your act is in.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Right. It's just doomed, and also I think there's a free sun in it, that it's going to turn nasty at any moment, which, unfortunately, it doesn't. It just ends up in a sort of playful headlock. But there's that simmering undercurrent of violence in it all the time.
Let's not finish this with an argument.
I thought status quo were going to be misbehaved, not shaky.
That was a wonderful Christmas present. Thank you very much.
Oh, he's being all chummy, just like Partridge would as well.
Let's catch up with Shaky's latest.
Merry
single.
Christmas, everybody!
Do you want to hear your single?
Do I?
You want to hear your single?
Yes. He's pissed
at
me.
Let's catch up with his latest single. You're mad. It's from an album called Marie Marie. It's called Marie Marie.
Okay. Marie Marie.
Made these fucking hating this. Fantastic sense of humour. Number three.
It's more
Madeley. It's more Judy. Quite a lot of Judy. Andrew, I know what's coming here. I think a lot of you do as well. Bit of a wardrobe malfunction coming up. Sergeant Pacitti. And you know what, nurse? She doesn't get the nits out, does she?
Judy Finnegan gave the hint of vinegar tits. Probably the biggest laugh in history. I love those moments when something, you know, happens that isn't supposed to happen.
Do you remember when Ian Brown threatened to batter Geffen Jones? I don't know who Geffen Jones is on T4. No, I don't,
I was
mate.
At home
I don't.
Watching that, like millions of other people.
Who?
And
who does her up in this? Somebody runs
outfit,
on the stage.
I thought, whoa, Judy's game, you know.
No, I'm not doing it. I am not doing it.
Oh, he thinks we want to do
it. He'll take care of me afterwards.
John Leslie, yeah.
No, I'm not doing it.
Oh, Judy.
One of the questions raised was, why was she wearing a white bra when you're wearing a black outfit?
Oh,
most
fuck
women
off. She can
know
do what she wants. She's royalty.
Black if you're wearing black underwear.
She's always seemed class, while Richard's the buffoon. There's John Leslie. Fuck it. She looks amazing for her age. Oh, she looks amazing anyway. Fucking fair play. And they dealt with it really well. This is not a number three TV moment from hell. She dealt with it tremendously well.
I never felt embarrassed by it at all. I just thought, there is a woman who looks fantastic. She's got great boobs.
Yes.
I think she's got a cracking figure.
I didn't mean it. Yes, great boobs.
If I can look like Judy Finnegan at 52, I will be made.
That's the right fucking outlook there.
Sorry about that.
She's class.
One last thing. If you vote for us next year, she'll show you both of them.
And Richard, uncharacteristically funny there. Oh, bless her. Good on her.
It has to be the most toe-curling...
More Richard Madeley, by any chance?
...cringe-making, awful, shambolic, shameful piece of television I have ever seen.
Meet and greet your host, Mick Fleetwood and Samantha Fox.
Ah, shit, yeah, this was awkward.
It was absurd right from the start. It's absurd.
But it's not worse than racism. Speaking of which, hello, Gary.
He was 3'2", and they come out and they look ridiculous. Hey.
She's out of control already.
You're right, chat. I don't know how the fuck we got through this without any savile on her. I'm very glad. What a cracking pair.
All you could hear around you was the sound of jaws hitting the floor and clanging, because it was just a nightmare.
Fabulous. He again earlier defending all that fucking racist bullshit. Woo! It was just a problem with the auto cue, really. There's the four tops.
No, I'm the one top. The four tops have been held up. They're putting their makeup on.
The run through was fine.
I like Paul George as well.
You know, it was perfect. I didn't have no worries at all. You know, no worries. It went smooth. Everything was working fine. What came up on the screen, I read, and it was fine. But on the night, the auto cue wasn't working properly.
So who's it going to be, Sam?
I don't know, because I can't see.
The lady operating it was about 70 or 80 years of age, couldn't hear very well. So as I'm talking, she can't hear me
talking.
Thanks
for that clip, mate.
She's not rolling up the screen.
Wind away.
OK.
And I'd look at Mick and for some help, and he'd just look at me. And I'd look at him, and I just wanted to run off the stage.
I don't really think you can blame Sam and Mick for it so much as the producers, because it was clearly under-rehearsed.
Prompt, Mick.
Well, no, she can't read the fucking auto.
So you made it here, all right? Well, that's good. Supposed to be in a wheelchair, lads. What happened? No stick, no wheelchair.
I'm not
a bit out. Well, anyhow, do you want me to tell you who's won, then?
Yeah.
How exactly are boobs worse than racism? The answer is they're not.
Are you not going to have a look at the possibilities first?
Other possibilities?
Yeah, the ordering is baffling here. I guess they didn't want to finish on a real downer, but
in
still.
In all the papers, because otherwise it would just be a disaster.
All the nonsense, Judy's tits falling out, and then top 10 is all racism and sexism.
Basically,
and
lies, really.
Mini pops.
You know, I knew what was going on. And I never bothered talking about it at that time because it would have kept it going on and on.
See you same time.
Fair play, she seems alright.
Same place next year.
I think it was I'd just get the script or something and rip it out and say, see you later. That's what I would have done. And left Mick up
number
there
one.
On his own, if it was now.
We've had a great time, and I hope you have. See you, we love you.
See you, we love you.
The road to hell, they say, number is one. Paved with good intentions.
And we've no doubt break.
That the untelevision title of the... Sometime, imagine if... Daytime TV. No survivors.
It's Ali G. It's bloody Richard as Ali G. Ali fucking Richard Madeley. Taking three of the top five.
Hello, welcome back. We're with you now live right through till 12:15. And Richard was in tears this weekend after the Sun News.
They're right that now.
No, he wasn't. He laughed his socks off. After the Sun newspaper pointed out this weekend twist. That he hasn't had a new hairstyle for the past 10 years.
We launched a campaign and we suggested maybe four different styles that he should adopt. One of which was Ali G, another was David Beckham. You know, we didn't think they'd go along with it.
We would like you to tell us which cut, which, you know, the Sun so carefully did
fuck
for us.
Sun.
They put up four computer simulations, would suit him best.
Franny, are you Travis? Travis making the number one spot.
Ali G was the way
come
to
on.
We had thousands of votes, but Ali G was by far the winner. So the idea was,
no,
well, if the viewer
you're
wants
right,
them,
no Keith Chegwin,
yes,
no Naked
TV
Jungle.
Some TV moments are just so bad.
Andrew,
good.
Using
and when
the
Richard Madeley was
Sergeant
bad, Pacitti, he was even
Pacitti,
better.
Sorry, fairly
in a parallel TV
sparingly,
universe, this really would be the greatest TV moment of all time, as Richard ends up finding heaven.
I thought
in
he did a right here.
When you realise what's happening, you start to
honestly, I thought he was a good sport about something that was a bit cringe and everything.
He's
but
going to do an Ali G impression, and this can end in nothing but tears.
Obviously, morning, it was awkward.
I was here with my Judy to ask her some questions about this morning. Oh. Now, Judy, when you is presenting with Richard, what does your real husband think?
Richard, you are my real husband.
I always thought you was like pretending.
No, Ali, we really are married.
Oh, respect.
You know,
I didn't
we
think
believe
he was that
it,
bad.
Because out of nowhere came this
it wasn't
amazing accent.
Tremendously funny
well,
or anything, but
actions.
Fucking number one.
You know, he's obviously a keen
I couldn't do an impression that well
what is
of
it
Ali.
About him that you like?
Well, he's very nice.
No, you know what I was meaning. What is it about him that you like?
Well, he's very kind and he can be extremely.
No, no. Judy, what is it about him, right, that, you know, makes you want the kids to go out away for a while and you go upstairs early to bed?
Oh, don't be so ridiculous. I'm not going to start stroking your ego here.
Oh, that would be wicked, though, Judy. Don't you think it would
be
the business
good
to
line.
Have some cooking on sometimes?
But we do. I mean, yesterday, for example, Susan Brooks was making cake in her Yorkshire kitchen.
Cake, for real?
Yeah.
Recency bias
say,
is right.
In defence of this, that the costumes is actually fantastic. The way he's learnt his lines is actually brilliant.
Yeah.
The attention to detail is really admirable. But you probably wouldn't want to watch it more than once.
Well,
why
fair.
Does he bother with I all the makeovers? Why don't you just get women who is fit to start with?
I mean, Rosemary Connolly's extremely fit, actually.
What, you was telling me you think Rosemary Connolly is fit?
Of course.
You was very frank, Judy.
I think he did really well. And as a sort of a mainstream sort of family entertainer, to go on ITV at 10 in the morning and allude to drug taking.
Everybody's
and
just going, like, why I mean, fuck is this number
good
one?
Lad, you know?
Yes, yes.
I think it's like stirring patriotic music.
Yeah, keep in mind this is fucking 10:30 in the morning as well, and he's getting away with this shit.
He's going to pull it off. Plucky old Richard.
Now, finally, I was noticing that there is no sign of Richard. Is it okay if Ali, does the show with you today?
What, looking like that? I'm afraid not.
Is it because I's black?
Oh. There it is.
Although it shouldn't work and it should be terrifying and you can feel yourself getting slick palmed with embarrassment on Richard's behalf in the early stages, I think he pulls it off.
Thank you. Thank you. Agreed.
Telepathy.
There we go. We're done. What is that at the bottom?
Another countdown for you next week. The cinema's greatest goodies and baddies in the AFI's 100
the
years,
big boss
100
man.
No,
it's
heroes
fucking
and villains.
Not.
Brad Renfrew is a college student who finds himself in an uneasy alliance with a former Nazi played by Ian McKellen.
It's not just Sergeant Slaughter.
Next.
It's the big boss for GE. Oh. Andrew, mate. Oh. Fantastic work. Fantastic. Oh, God, no. No, he's coming towards us. No, stop. Please stop. Please stop. That's your lot. Goodness gracious me. Well, what stream's this been? Have you guys enjoyed this? I realised that it was, obviously we were watching some pretty controversial stuff, and I hope nobody has been offended. This stuff is still repeated all the time on Channel 4 and various other clip shows like this. And it has been a look back at some of the darker times in TV history. Stuff that we're by no means celebrating, of course. Just a final disclaimer there. So much appreciated. Wrong screen, what have I done here? Oh, shit. Talking all over Matthew Kelly there. Apologies. Yeah, so thank you once again. Yeah, well, just in case you didn't hear me, disclaimer, it's been a look back at some really fucking horrible stuff and some pretty funny stuff as well, I think it's fair to say. So yeah, thank you very much. It all went a bit, that Maggie Thatcher one really got me earlier. But it's been a good 3 hours, I think. I've enjoyed myself. So thank you so much for tuning in, everybody. Cheers for the stream today. It was such a good laugh. Andrew is the MVP with the editing on this. Agreed. Big love to you. Big love to you as well, Stephen. Sounds like you need to prove it with an impression, Adam. That's not happening. I'm not doing an Ali G. Right, who we raiding then? Who's online? Let me know who's online and we'll do a raid. And Matt, thank you so much for all the bits there, Matt. What a ride, what a stream, what a hero Sergeant Pacitti is. Thank you so much. Thanks for the stream, pal. Cake, thank you very, very much. I've got to go. I can't do any more shows. OSW review? We'll do that. WWE? Raid WWE? No, I think we'll give it to somebody who's going to appreciate it, maybe. So Kip Sabian, we're coming. Oh, no, right. OSW review are getting the raid. Thank you again to everybody who's subbed, who's gifted subs, who's donated, who's spent the bits and all that stuff. Thank you very much. More of that, please, Treacle. Fucking brilliant. I'll keep an eye out for more stuff like that because I've really enjoyed it today. I think it's been a lot of fun. And again, apologies to anyone who's offended. I tried to make it very clear that we were going to see stuff that would be uncomfortable. We're certainly not celebrating it, as I say. So yeah, thank you very much. Please do also tune in tomorrow. 4 p.m. I'm going live. We're going to watch something tomorrow. Oh, we're going to watch Big Fat Quiz of the Year from like 2006 or something like that. And also the charity stream in memory of John Huber, of Brody Lee. We're going to stream AEW Dynamite with 100% of the proceeds going to charity. So thank you ever so much. We're going to do a raid now. Pick a live channel to raid. OSW review. They got 77 people watching right now, so let's give them a few more, shall we? And that's your lot, guys. I'm starting the raid. But most importantly, not only will I see you tomorrow, I'll see you for SmackDown as well, but I will see you next Tuesday. Take care of yourselves. See you soon. Thanks for watching tonight. Goodbye. Good night.